So we're out to Facebook at present time. So listen, we just magnify the Spirit of the Lord on today. And we thank the Lord. And let me open up here and do a little sharing. Can we just type in there to let everybody know to share? And I'm going to share to the hubs here. And we'll let everybody start coming in. And I shared to the one, now the second one. Okay, we're out to the hubs. Sister Asia's in with us on the live Facebook forum. That's Dr. Peace's daughter. Sister Asia, we just praise the Lord for you. Listen, saints, we're coming live from Cox Community Church of Dallas, Texas on today. And we just bless the Lord for all our family and friends all across the world. And for sharing life in him, listen, and sharing his word with you. We just thank the Lord. We're in Dallas, Texas here. It's a sunny day. And we just bless the Lord. We have everybody in the live Zoom forum here. And this is our afternoon service. This is the North American Watchman's Council. We're standing in proxy for I Give You Peace Ministries Incorporated. And Pastor Dr. Peace, while she's out recovering, and she's coming along nicely. Bishop V, we just thank the Lord for you. Bishop Verrill Mitchell's with us from the Tri-City Upstate area, Dominion House of Restoration, and Pastor Sheba Mitchell, we just honor your presence in the service on this afternoon. And we just thank the Lord for his grace. We thank the Lord for his mercy. And we have a great man of God with us. We bless the Lord for our First Lady Jennifer's here with us, and she's going to give us our scripture reading a little later on. And we just thank the Lord. Saints, as you're coming in, please share the broadcast and hit the reaction buttons. That's going to help the message disseminate. Somebody needs to hear the work of the word of the Lord. We know that many people are in their services, but there are many people that are not that view the broadcast. So let's continue to share. Let's continue to hit the reaction buttons. And I assure you, no one's going to want to miss this broadcast. So we thank the Lord for all the saints that will be coming in from around the contiguous United States of America and the international community. We bless the Lord for all of you and all of you that will watch these videos. There's so many that watch the videos even after the broadcast has gone off. So we thank the Lord. We thank the Lord for all the saints that were in our morning service. What a blessed time we have. The Spirit of the Lord really spoke to us. If you missed that, you can go on our Facebook page, Cox Community Church of Dallas, Texas, and you can get that. And also, the team is working diligently to have it up on YouTube for you. If you're not subscribed to YouTube, just type my name in on the YouTube platform, and the church channel for YouTube will come up. And there's over 350 videos on there now, 2 to 6 hours a piece, all high prophetic import. And you got, you know, anywhere from 2 to 6 hours of teaching on each video on a wide array of topics as the Spirit of the Lord has led us over the past 4 years. So please go on there. And when you're on there, please subscribe. Please hit the notification bell. So every time the media team puts a new video up, you will be able to receive that teaching. It's totally free. There are so many that are charging for their platforms in this hour, but the Spirit of the Lord laid on our heart here at Cox Community Church of Dallas, Texas, just to keep everything free so that you can go in and receive the word of the Lord. All right. So we thank the Lord. Brother Rolinski Alphonse, we thank the Lord for you, sir, and your beautiful wife and your family. And certainly remember you all. And we pray for you all here in Dallas, Texas. And we thank the Lord. Many of you are on our international prayer list, which is prayed over daily. If you'd like to be on our international prayer list, just drop us a line on Messenger, Facebook, however you get it to us, and we will add you to that international prayer list. We are a praying ministry. We are a praying council. The Watchman's Council is a fellowship of churches that have decided to come together and do the work of the Lord. The whole entire fivefold ministry is represented in the council. We have prophets, apostles, pastors, teachers, and evangelists. We have all of the saints. Every ministry gift is representative. The power of the Holy Ghost is truly in our churches and truly in our council. And the Lord, as we are experiencing mighty miracles, signs, and wonders of the Lord, and so much so that the Lord laid on First Lady Jen's heart to fire up Tuesday night testimony service so that you guys could give your testimonies, because the Lord is doing mighty things of which we are so thankful and so grateful for. We're getting ready to open up in prayer, and we're going before the throne of grace. And I love the word of the Lord says, therefore, we can come boldly before the throne of grace to do what? To obtain mercy and to find grace to help in the time of need. And so we thank the Spirit of the Lord for his grace and his mercy. And we just magnify the Spirit of the Lord. I am going to confirm that right there. Brother Chavez, I confirmed your friend request, so you should be able to see us now. If you're on and for some reason you're having trouble, Pastor Sheba, we just honor your presence here in the service on this afternoon. Saints, if for some reason you're having trouble seeing the video, if you're not directly connected to us on Facebook, send us a friend request. We'll answer it, and then you'll be able to come in and you'll be able to see the broadcast, and we'll answer them. I have the ability to answer them. First Lady can answer them. Pick one of us, send a friend request. We'll get you in there and you'll be able to view. It's already shared on the Facebook page. So once you receive that friend request as answered, you should be able to view us. All right. So if anybody wants to have that direct connection, just send a Facebook request. We'll hit it. Many of you are already connected. And so you're already in the loop. So you already know what time it is. So we magnify the Spirit of the Lord. We have Brother Chavez Gibbs with us. His camera is off, so you're not able to see him there in the live Facebook form. And but we do have this brother with us, along with Brother Jeremiah Parsons, and many of you, especially in that Tri-City Upstate area, you already know. I don't even have to introduce this young man, but I'm going to let him introduce himself for the international community and many of you that may not know him, especially all the saints here in Dallas, Texas. So we just magnify the Spirit of the Lord. Let's go before the throne of grace, and then we'll go further in the service. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you on this morning. First of all, on this afternoon, Father, we thank you that we are gathered together in your name, and you said in your word, where two or three are gathered together in your name, there you are in the midst of us. Father, we celebrate you. We exalt you. We lift you up right now. We magnify you and we worship you in the beauty of holiness. There's no one like you in all the heavens and in all the earth. We are not as those that are trapped in pseudo and quasi religions, those, Lord, that are walking in the darkness, but we are the children of the light because your precious Holy Ghost dwells in us, that we will not stumble in the darkness. And so, Father, we come into your presence on this afternoon to hear your heart, to hear your mind. Father, we ask that you would demonstrate your power and your presence by your Holy Ghost in this service, and that there will be no life that will not be touched as they lead this service, that everyone will be touched by the convicting power and the presence of our precious Holy Ghost, because you said in your word, Father, he has come to convict this world of judgment, sin, and righteousness. And Father, we are not those that put our hand to the plow and draw back unto perdition. We are not as those that do not receive your correction and your instruction, not just your blessing as you give it to us. So Father, we thank you on today. We give you honor. We give you glory. We exalt you. We magnify you in this service, Lord. So many are going through things and they have not yet learned to magnify you above those things, because the magnification of your presence and your power and your glory is what brings the deliverance, brings the healing, brings the answer right on the scene, Father. Everyone takes your convicting power as something negative, but your convicting power is a power that will come and make the crooked ways straight. It'll make straight narrow paths broader, and it'll make broader paths where destruction might enter in narrow, to where no destruction can get in. You will take valleys and you will take mountains and turn them into valleys. And Lord, you even grant your servants to be able to speak and remove mountains right out of our very lives. Father, you are worthy to be praised, Lord, and we thank you that you are in and upon us today. Father, you are in this service, and Lord, we decrease right now as you increase. Father, if there's anybody amongst us, Lord, that has missed the mark, that is sin, Lord, that has said or done something they shouldn't have done, Lord, we ask that you forgive us right now in the name of Jesus, that we might stand holy in your presence, and not just today, but in the day of redemption. For you said you're going to try the heart of every man and every woman upon this planet. You know every secret thing, and you are going to search it out by your judgment and give to every man the reward that he is justly due, for your holiness will not be mocked and it will not be violated. Father, we thank you on today. Lord, speak through your servant on today. Anoint this young man in the fire power of the Holy Ghost, that as he opens his mouth, your majestic heart and mind will come through his words, and the Holy Ghost will lace his words so that all that hear will be deeply touched by your presence and your power and your spirit. Father, we have gathered in your name today. This is all about you. We have not come to see men. We have not come to see popularity and the fame of men, but we have gathered today to seek your heart and to seek your mind and to understand what you are saying to us, so we can not only be hearers and keepers of that word, but we can go into this world and be doers of that word. For you have called us to go into all nations and teach them whatsoever you have commanded us. Father, we bless you on today. We give you honor and we give you glory. Let your firepower fall fresh in this place. Power fill every temple of the Holy Ghost, which is our bodies that we have presented to you, a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto you, Lord, which is our reasonable service. And we are not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, Father, that in this service we are going to prove what is your good, acceptable, and perfect will. Father, we bless you on today. We give you honor and glory. King Jesus, we magnify you. Precious Holy Ghost, we sit at your feet now, waiting for you as the master teacher to teach us as only you can. Glorify yourself in this service, Father, and we'll be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise that only you are due, because you're the only God in this universe, and all other gods are dead, and there is no other Savior beside thee. And you said you will not share your glory with another, for you are a jealous God, and you are all-consuming fire. Father, we bless you on today, and we love you because you first loved us. In King Jesus' name, we thank you, Father. Amen and amen. Saints, we just want to bless the Lord for everybody that's still coming in. Evangelist Tiana Sanders, we thank the Lord for you, ma'am. Saints, let's go ahead and share the broadcast. Somebody is going to want to hear the word of the Lord on this afternoon, and I'm so excited that we have Brother Jeremiah Parsons with us, and so excited to just be in the presence of the Lord with Brother Jeremiah. First Lady's with us. First Lady, you ready to give us the scripture, our holy sacred scriptures on this afternoon service? Then, Saints, we're going to go into worship, and then we're going to put that giving information. As soon as First Lady reads the scriptures, we're going to get that giving information up for you, and I'll go through that in a moment. Let's hear the word of the Lord, then we'll talk about this giving information a little bit. We're going to worship, and then we're going to get to the sanctified point of the hour, which is hearing the word of the Lord. I'm so excited to that Brother Jeremiah is going to share with us today, and I'm so excited. And Brother Jeremiah, we thank the Lord again for you receiving our invitation and coming on. Such a blessing to have you here, sir. Lady Jen, we're ready for you, ma'am, when you're ready.
Yes, I'll be reading from Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 through 4, and Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11 through 15. And Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 through 4 reads, "Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by the angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness, both the signs and wonders, and with diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will." And Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11 through 15. "Now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled."
Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Saints, the key to those two scriptures there is in Hebrews, the second chapter, we're to not let slip the word that we've heard. And in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, we're not to fail of the grace of the Lord that he's invested in us as believers. So we don't want that to be lost upon you. A lot of times we're reading these holy scriptures and the principle of the Lord is lost upon us. And so we are not to let slip what we have heard from the word of the Lord. And we're getting ready to hear the word of the Lord in a few moments here. And we're not to fail of the grace of the Lord that he's invested in us by the baptism of the Holy Ghost. So that is the two most critical points in those scriptures as we amalgamate them together. All right. Now, I'm going to ask the media team to put the given information up there, and I'm going to go over this given information so we can start the giving process now, saints. I'm going to ask you to search your heart. Dr. Peace, we just thank the Lord for you being with us, ma'am, and we honor your presence here on this morning. All right, the given information is on the screen. Now, I want to say this. The first thing is, every cent that you give is going to go to I Give You Peace Ministries, Incorporated, Pastor Dr. Peace, all the saints there. They are doing a tremendous work. Now, all Sister Karen Campbell, we just thank the Lord for you, ma'am, and your husband, Harold, and the whole entire family. We just bless the Lord for you. There are four ways to give, and every cent that you give goes to I Give You Peace Ministries. There are meals that are being given. There are various things that the ministry does. If you'd like to know their vision and everything that they have going on, please call Dr. Peace. Reach out to her, and they're going to share the vision with you, all right? But every cent that you give goes to I Give You Peace Ministries for the work that the Lord is doing. They're serving the Troy area in the Tri-City upstate area. You have Troy, Schenectady, and Albany. And so they're serving over there in Troy. And we just magnify the Spirit of the Lord. So you have PayPal listed there. If you see where it says see more, just hit that. It'll open it up. You have four ways to give. You have PayPal. You have Cash App at $WalkOfPeace. If you're going to send by mail, you want to do 30 3rd Street, Troy, New York, 12180. And if you're going to call pledges in, you say, you know, Apostle, I don't have it today, but I can give it on Thursday or Friday, whatever the case may be. You can call your pledge in at 518-522-5171. So you have four ways to give. The team will come back and they'll put that information up there several more times. And also there's a GoFundMe because Dr. Peace came home and there's some work being done to the house so that she, because she has a wheelchair, so she has to be able to get in and out. That work process has already started. If you like to be a part of that process, there's a GoFundMe link right there in the chat. Please just open that up and you can go to GoFundMe and donate right there. And we just thank the Lord in advance for your compassion, for your care, for your heart. And again, the work has already begun. We have an excellent construction company that's doing the work. And we're not just about praying, saints. We're about acting. We're about giving. We're about making sure that the work gets done from the start to the finish. See, many folks pray for you, but they don't pray all the way through to the finish of what the Lord is answering you, especially when we're talking about a restoration process. So we don't just pray for people. If there is a situation, we're going to pray you all the way through to the end, okay? And that's critical. So yeah, four ways to give there. You have your GoFundMe link there right in the comments. Pastor Dr. Rhonda Ferguson, we just thank the Lord for you, Dr. Rhonda, being with us. So glad to that you're with us, ma'am. And it's so excellent to see you and service with us. And we honor you in the spirit of the Lord. All the saints from around the contiguous United States of America, we honor the Lord for your presence. All of those that are coming in from the international community, many of you were with us this morning. We thank the Lord for your presence. And so we just magnify the Spirit of the Lord. Listen, we're excited. We got Brother Jeremiah Johnson with us and many of you in that Tri-City upstate area. Sister Nyasia Monique, we thank the Lord for you coming in, ma'am. Saints, please share. Somebody needs to hear the word of the Lord. You are going to want, you are going to enjoy what the Lord is going to speak to us about. You're going to enjoy this exchange. And many of you, you were with us when we had all the brothers on and we were having a discussion about what's going on in our country. and in ministry. And then many of you were on when we had all the ladies on. Matter of fact, Dr. Rhonda was with us, and Elder Lucy, and we had Pastor Sheba from Dominion House of Restoration. If you missed any of those broadcasts, just go right on YouTube. They're all up there for you, and you can watch those. Now we got Brother Jeremiah. We're excited. And we're going to have a little discussion. Grab your coffee, grab your water, grab your juice. I got mine. Matter of fact, I'm going to take a sip if you don't mind. Whatever's going to tickle your fancy. We're just going to have a little fireside chat here with Brother Jeremiah. All right, we're going into worship now. And Sister Asia's going to be leading us in worship. Just bear with me. We're going to do a little, I'm telling you, Sister Karen, I got my coffee too. I am a coffee man. I got a mug that says coffee and Jesus, and that's all I need to run on. I'm going to tell you right now, and the firepower of the Holy Ghost. So I got my coffee. First Lady's got her coffee. We are ready to go. Sister Nyjah, we just honor the Spirit of the Lord for you, ma'am, and so glad you can be with us. Saints, please continue to share. Somebody is going to want to hear the word of the Lord and hear what we're getting ready to discuss and talk about. The Spirit of the Lord is truly in this place. Give me a second. We're going to switch screens here so we can go into worship. And Sister Asia is going to be leading us in worship, so we're so excited about that. And so we're going to bring her in here. And let me see here. Hit that. Share sound. Thank you.
curiosity. See if I can do it.
Jesus. How many are so glad they made it? I don't know about you, but I am so glad. I'm telling you, so glad I made it. And Brother Jeremiah, if you want to jump in there, because I know you can send us to church, brother, feel free to jump in if you want to jump in, because I know you can sing that one. I ain't going to touch it, though, because I don't have no Marvin Sapp voice, you know what I'm saying? You got to be careful some songs you touch, right? So Minister LeVar Beeks, we thank the Lord for you, sir. And I saw Sister Doreen Mosier come in. Sister Doreen, we thank the Lord for you. Saints, as you're coming in, please continue to share the broadcast. Somebody, as I'm telling you, Bishop V, I am so glad that I made it. I've been through a lot of things, and I know many have. I'm so glad that I made it. And, you know, the older you get, you know, you get battle tested and you get tried, and the Lord makes sure that you're tested. So we honor your presence here, Minister LeVar. We thank the Lord for you, sir, and we bless the Lord for you. And I don't know about you, I am so glad that I made it. The Lord has kept me each and every day of my life. I just turned 49, and I'm so thankful that I made it. There was a time I didn't think that I was going to see 18 years old, and it's kind of a curse that runs in our family. My father didn't think he was going to make it to a certain age, and quite frankly, we had good reason to think that, because there are many in our family that didn't. And so my father is headed towards 90 years old now, and I myself am just turned 49, so I'm telling you, the Lord has brought me way past 18 years old, and I have a few gray hairs on my head, and I've never been so excited to see the first one that came up in my hair, because it was a time I didn't think. And the reason I shout about that, because our Bible tells us, the Lord said, I will be with you to the hoar hairs, H-O-A-R, the King James says, but it's translated as gray hairs on your head. So this gray, these few grays I have, I'm excited to see them, because there was a time when I didn't even think I was going to make it past 18. So to be 49, I'll take these few little grays. Hopefully that's all there is. It's just a few. And because I'm a little vain like that, and I'd like the Lord to touch me so I look way younger than I actually am, you know. So y'all pray for me as I pray for you, you know. And you know, I thank the Lord. See, one time I Brother Jeremiah is on with us from the Tri-City Upstate area. One time he did a post about his waves. You remember that, Brother Jeremiah? And I said, now the key is, I say, your hair looks awesome, but the key is to get my age and you still have a few waves. I still got a few, Jeremiah. It ain't like yours. It ain't like it used to be. It's not like yours anymore because I don't age, but I still got a few trying to hang on there, you know. And so, you know, that's the key, is to get a little older and you still have a few. You can kind of see them a little bit. When my hair gets longer, they show a little better. But I still got a few, Jeremiah. You know, it ain't like it used to be, you know. So I'm not saying they're gonna be like that, you know, but just a little something. But we just we thank the Lord, and Dr. Peace, we're just continuing to pray for you, ma'am. And we're thankful that you are home and that all is well, and that you did that so many hearts and minds were touched when you were in that rehabilitation center. And that's what it's about, saints. Everywhere we go, we ought to be a light. Media team, can you throw the, I need those, get the giving information up there again. I'm going to go over that one more time. And then Brother Jeremiah, we are going into this, sir. I'm so excited. For those of you that may not know, Brother Jeremiah is Dr. Paul Parsons' son. Okay. And so many of you, all of you in the upstate area know this, but I'm saying this for the benefit of others. And so again, every cent that you give, the given information is back in there. Every cent that you give goes to help I Give You Peace Ministries Incorporated, with the vision and the mandate that the Lord has given them. Dr. Peace and I have been together a long time. We go back to about 2006. So we've been together quite a little. We've been together quite a while. So I know her well. She knows me. And if I thought you were going to sow into something crazy, I would tell you, because I'm not scared of anybody, I would tell you not to sow. But I know that when you sow, matter of fact, she was one of the key architects of us coming to the Tri-City area and evangelizing. She laid the groundwork physically for us to be there, got us in all the venues, got all the paperwork filed. If it wasn't for Dr. Peace, we might have been in trouble. But when the Lord, how many know when the Lord gives you a revelation and commands you to do something, he's going to send able and skilled people that help you carry that assignment out. And the Spirit of the Lord laid on my heart to come to the Tri-City area. I'd evangelized it with Dr. Guthrie. Many of you remember him. I evangelized that same Tri-City area 25 years earlier with him in those same identical places. And the Lord laid on my heart to go back. We lost Dr. Guthrie this year. So minister the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, because I was thinking of him. And so we got through it. We magnify the Spirit of the Lord. Not only did we get through it, the Lord showed up by a demonstration of his power and his presence. And if you missed any of that, the media team captured it for you. First Lady Jen had all the folks out there and they were capturing him. So if you missed anything, we got it for you. Go on YouTube, all three: Riverfront Park, Central Park in Schenectady, Riverfront Park in Troy, and Swinburne Park in Albany. We got all three for you, all right? So you can go watch those and get yourself up to speed. Apostle John DeGraff, we thank the Lord for you there, sir, in North Carolina. We bless the Lord for you on today. So glad that you can be in with us. And Apostle Rosalie, we thank the Lord for your wife, the Apostle, and all of the saints out there in North Carolina. We just bless the Lord for all of you on this afternoon. Listen, saints, please continue to invite many in, because they need to hear the word of the Lord. And trust me, we're going to want to hear hear this, especially if you're concerned about our youth. You are going to want to hear this discussion. Trust me when I tell you, the Holy Ghost laid in my heart to do this. He made a way for Brother Jeremiah to be with us, and we coordinated because Brother Jeremiah is serving in ministry, and he's all over the place. So he's not easy like he was when he was younger to catch up with, all right? Now, he's still a young man. He's super young, but when he's a little bit younger, it was a little bit easier to catch him. Now that everybody wants him all over the place, and trust me, he's one of the greatest voices of our time, and really any time, one of the greatest voices. And so people are calling on him, and the Lord has double gifted him in the word and with singing. And so he has a unique perspective on the youth. So please alert everybody. We're going to be discussing the youth. And if you care about the youth in any way, shape, or form, let's get everybody in here so they can hear what the man of God is going to say concerning the youth. All right. Brother Jeremiah, sir, you might as well flip the mic on, and we're ready for you, sir. And I would just ask, I have some questions from Brother Jeremiah, and we're going to discuss some things here. Sister Selena, we just thank the Lord for you, ma'am. So good to see you on this afternoon. And we thank the Lord for you. Sister Selena is doing an excellent work also out in the Troy area. A lot of people are being fed because of the ministry that she's leading and all the servants with her. So we thank the Lord for her. If you'd like to find out how you can help Plates with Prayers, just go get in contact with her, because they are feeding a tremendous amount of people right along with I Give You Peace Ministries Incorporated. These are your feeders, saints. So if you care about the homeless, you care about those that need a meal, and in this economy now, there's starting to be many more. So if you care about that work and you want a great place to sow your gifts, you want a great place to sow, you want to get with them and make sure you sow, because they're out there. You go on their Facebook pages, they're out there feeding people. We're not talking about the play version either. So great place to sow. So you got your four ways to give up there for I Give You Peace Ministries. You got your PayPal, Cash App, $ Walk a Piece, by mail if you're going to send, 303rd Street, Troy, New York. The zip code is 12180. And if you're calling in your pledges, you say, I don't have it right now, Apostle, but I'm willing to give it on XYZ day, call the ministry there at 518-522-5171. And they're standing by there to take your pledge, all right? We're discussing the youth. And so we have Brother Jeremiah Parsons. Brother Jeremiah, what we're going to begin with is I'm just going to ask you to kind of give an introduction any way that you see fit. Let the Lord use you. Going to ask you to introduce yourself a little bit for those that may not know you, sir.
All right, my name is Jeremiah Parsons. I'm from Albany, New York. I serve at New Birth Christian Fellowship Center. Well, my pastor is Dr. Paul J. Parsons Sr., who's also my father, and my mother, Marva Parsons. I serve as a youth leader and a praise and worship leader there. I am a husband. I have a wife. We've been married for 2 years, going on three. I have a daughter who's 1.5 years old, and I'm an eighth grade social studies teacher at Kip Albany Community Charter Middle School, which is on the south end of Albany. Outside of there, I sing in a group called Authentic Worship. It's a group of young adults. We come together and we minister through song.
Yeah. Brother Jeremiah, is Authentic Worship, do you guys have a site or anything so far? I know you guys just came together. Is there anything in place right now that we can go and just kind of track you guys? And
I don't think there's a site right now, but I'll definitely keep you informed if anything.
Okay. All right. Yes, please do, because we like to track you guys. So when you guys go places, you know, if somebody just flips the phone on, nice and easy, right to Facebook. Yeah. And we like to be in those services with you. And that's what we do a lot of times. We would just turn these phones, trust me, are better than a lot of special. They're cameras, and they broadcast in 1080. So we just we like to be a part of the ministry and you know, kind of travel with you guys. So if they want to fire up a Facebook page so that we can follow, that would be awesome. Authentic Worship, I love that. And I'm telling you, Brother Jeremiah is so humble, but if you ever hear Brother Jeremiah sing, you'll never forget it. He has a one-of-a-kind voice, And I just magnify the Spirit of the Lord. His mother, First Lady Marva Parsons, is a great worship leader, longtime worship leader in the Tri-City upstate area, traveled all over. His father is one of the greatest preachers of our time, Pastor Dr. Paul Parsons. Dr. Parsons and I have been friends, I think, since 1996. And we've preached all over the place and traveled together. And Brother Jeremiah and his siblings grew up with my children. And so know their family very well. Many of you know their family very well. They're very well known in the Tri-City upstate area. New Birth Christian Center there in the upstate area, right in Albany. And you guys also have a large daycare, if I'm not mistaken, right? There's a daycare being operated. So listen, if you need your kids to go somewhere and there's open enrollment, you want to get over there. I can vouch for the daycare because I've watched it operate pretty much almost from the beginning. So I think it was the beginning, actually, if I think about it correctly. So if your children need to be in a safe environment and a Christian environment, I'm going to go around that block again for everybody in the back of the classroom. If you want them in a Christian environment, because now, I've been in the public schools teaching. I've been a substitute teacher, teaching assistant, all the way right up to the doctoral and master's in universities. And I can tell you, it is getting so crazy in these schools that we need to begin to pray for our teachers and to pray righteous teachers in our schools. We need to pray teachers. You know, when I was a teaching assistant at Albany High, Brother Jeremiah, I was there tutoring in the library one day, and there was a Christian fellowship. There was a fellowship of young believers there in the high school, and they were holding gatherings, and they invited me. And so it's so awesome. When they looked around, they said, we don't know of anybody else, any of the adults that are believers, but I was sharing the word of the Lord with one of the students, and one who was in that gathering happened to hear me, and they ended up inviting me, and I went too. I told them I would be there, and I went. That's what we need. We need holiness back in our public schools. How many know that our school teachers are not babysitters? I'm gonna pause right there and let that sink deep down in. Our teachers are not babysitters. That means that it starts at home. We're going to get into that. Brother Jeremiah, is there anything else, Lord, anything else in your introduction you want to share with us? Are you good, sir? Okay, so we're going to get into this first question here. Again, I'm going to ask everybody to please share. We've already shared to the hubs, and if you have any other hubs we're unaware of, any Facebook groups, any type of groups, let's share, because we're talking about the young people today. And the reason the Lord laid in my heart to have Brother Jeremiah come on is he's not just working with the youth inside the church, he's also working with them outside the church, and he's working with the critical age. Notice he said eighth grade, right, Brother Jeremiah? Eighth grade. He's working with your eighth graders, okay? That's a very tricky age, because you're slipping into pubescence, okay? So you got hormones, you got nerves getting aggravated. They walk out the door one way. Come on, I have children, I know. They walk out the door one way. Now I have grandchildren, Brother Jeremiah, go figure that one. And they walk out the door one day one way, come back in, and you don't even know who they are. So if you don't know who they are, how do we expect the teachers to do something with them, okay? So I'm going to tell you, Brother Jeremiah, I always partnered with the teachers that were teaching my children. I gave them email address, telephone number, everything, 911 in case you need to get arrested. Whatever you needed, the teachers had it for me. And I said to them, call me, and don't let the first time you speak to me be at a parent-teacher conference, or I'm going to be upset. If my children are out of line, you call me. And I'm going to tell you something. Five children, come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost, five children, and I never got I got two calls from that school, and all the time my children went to school, two calls, and one They tried to, five girls jumped on my daughter. She sent three to the emergency room. I bet they won't try that again. And so she wasn't in the wrong. And the second call I got, the second one I got, was for my, second to youngest son. You remember Brandon, Brother Jeremiah. I got a call for him, and this guy wanted to fight with him over some young lady that wasn't even worth it. So I went up there and straightened that out. Two calls out of five children in all those years, because I partnered with the teachers. Parents, I shouldn't even have to say this to believe in parents, but I'm going to say it anyway, because many people watch this video, these videos, and some aren't even saved. If you are not partnering with your children's teachers, get partnered. Make sure they got an email. Now we got Facebook, YouTube, whatever it takes, Messenger, DMs on everything, email, websites, whatever you need, telephone numbers to each telephone you have. You should be partnered with the teachers in your children's education. Now, we can sit and complain about this, or the Lord can give us blueprints and prophetic instructions so that we can turn this thing around. And I'll tell you right now, if we turn this thing around, our schools will stop getting shot up. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. All right. So we want the schools to stop getting shot up. And Father, in the name of Jesus, protect Brother Jeremiah, all of the educators, because Brother Jeremiah is also a part of a core of young black educators, men in particular. We need more men in the educational system. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. Stop demonizing the men. There could be a demon everywhere you go. If we're going to base men not teaching our children on one demon, then we might as well just throw everybody out the door, okay? So there's always, Satan's always going to try to infiltrate, but listen to this. That's why we want holy men and righteous men like Brother Jeremiah teaching our children. We ought to uplift these men, bless these men, and certainly pray for them. We're praying for our schools, okay? We need to pray for our schools, our teachers, but more than that, we need to partner with them, not complain about what's going on. Let's be a part of the PTAs. I was in my children's PTA for all of those years. Let's partner with the PTA. If the first time, let me set the bar here. If the first time your teacher's talking to you, parent, is at a parent-teacher conference, you missed the Lord. You didn't just miss the public school system. You missed the Lord. Okay? Let's partner with our children. I said it, Brother Jeremiah. They said, this guy is crazy. We already know that. We're just waiting on you to figure it out. Okay? Yeah. I've been crazy. It's been like this, for 30 years I've been minister. It's not going to get any better, I assure you, okay? So, and thank you, Dr. Rhonda. Dr. Rhonda's on here, Dr. Rhonda Ferguson. She also teaches in the school and been teaching for many years, so I got all my teachers here. I'm a teacher myself. So there's so many of us, and we understand this. Partner with the teachers in your children's school. You should know what's going on at all times. This is how we keep them from having babies early, babies out of wedlock, all kind of mess that can go on, fighting, shooting, killing, stealing. We have to begin to take a part. And let me say this, saints, we have got to find a way. And I'm going to tell you where we do it. We got to infiltrate these PTA meetings and get prayer back in the school. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. That is really up to your superintendent. Okay, you pay taxes, then you're paying your superintendent's paycheck. Let's get in these PTA meetings. Let's get the superintendents down there. I think it was Dr. Eva Joseph that was the superintendent back when I was teaching in the Albany public school system there. I was with Principal Kim Wilkins, and then was transferred to Principal Karen Ford was at Albany High. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. So those PTA meetings are a great time to say, hey, can we get the superintendent down here? We need to talk to him and her about getting prayer back in the schools. And let me say this, because I'm crazy and I know you haven't figured it out yet. You're going to figure it out fast. We're not talking about prayer where the Muslims are leading it, the Hindus, the Brahmins, which are your future shamans. We're not talking about all these other religions that we've let in the country, which the term for that in theology is pluralism. Okay, we're not talking about that, all right? So let's get in these meetings and call the superintendents down and say, we need prayer back in the schools. And watch this. I guarantee your school will not get shot up. I guarantee it. You'll see the Spirit of the Lord coming there. Put them children back on that system. Fire that PA system back up. Install TVs. I don't care what you have to do. Put them over that mic system and let them say the Pledge of Allegiance and let them pray before the God of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, whose son is Jesus Christ. And watch how safe your school system and your schools will be. We need to pray righteous superintendents of the schools back up in there. And by the way, all of you charter schools, you have no excuse, because your funding doesn't necessarily come from those that can manipulate you into something else. So every charter school, you have no excuse, because there's nobody there telling you what to do. So you're setting the show. Okay, so all we need is those that will dare to be righteous, dare to believe the word of the Lord. And saints, guess what? Since we're paying taxes and we're funding the school system, we ought to use the PTA meetings as a way to lean in on those that are leading the school systems and get them to restore prayer to the school, get them to restore. There was a horrible prison right here in Louisiana, one in Mississippi. And there's one here, there's a few here in Texas and in those states, but there's some of the most terrible prisons in these three states. The preachers started going in, and the wardens were working with the men and the men of God and the women of God, and immediately the crime rate in the prison went down to where it was barely perceptible. To one prison, Brother Jeremiah, they were able to move the bars completely and do open squad bays. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. Don't tell me the Holy Ghost can't change an atmosphere or an environment. He can, all right? So let's partner with our teachers. Let's lean in on these school board systems and on our superintendents, and get prayer and the Pledge of Allegiance back in the schools. You know why? Because when we were standing there at 5, 6, 7, and 8, okay, and we're speaking the Pledge of Allegiance, we're declaring the blessing over the country. When we're praying, now we're praying the blessing over the country. So we were declaring the blessing and praying the blessing. And Brother Jeremiah, there were shootings as we went to school. There were shootings in other places, but our schools never got shot up. And Lady Jen and I are from Detroit, Michigan, when it was the murder capital for 30 years. We're talking about the number one place in the world you could lose your life. And our schools did not get shot up. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. The reason our schools are getting shot up now, since Columbine, and we're clearly in the thousands now. Since that time, let me tell you why they're getting shot up. Because some idiot lady by the name of Madeline Murray O'Hare decided, in her atheistic spirit, she was going to go and petition the Supreme Court back in 1970, have prayer taken out of the school. Thank you, Madeline Murray O'Hare, for your scumbag reality now that has caused thousands of children to die because you decided that you want to be an idiot. By the way, we always talk about what people do. Let me tell you, she ended up in a shallow grave somewhere. They couldn't find her for 20 years. Her, one of her sons, and her granddaughter were butchered. They were dismembered, put in a shallow grave that nobody could find for 20 years. And the one son that survived, let me tell you about the one son. The one son that survived is a blood-washed, born-again, sanctified believer in the Holy Ghost, tried to tell his daughter, her granddaughter, not to be over there with him. She wouldn't listen. The granddaughter perished, but her other son, who's the believer and a pastor, by the way, Brother Jeremiah, is alive today. See, we always talk about what these evil people do, but we don't just put the camera on them when they're doing evil. Put the camera on it to show the destruction that comes to them at the end. Thank you, everybody, for typing names in the chat, because they're being covered by the Holy Ghost right now. And when we close in prayer, the Holy Ghost is going to put the serious firepower on their lives and begin to work in their lives and begin to invite them in our services, saints. They need to hear the word of the Lord. All right, Brother Jeremiah. Let's settle down here, because I'm in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. It don't take much for me to turn into a raging inferno. And so let's discuss it. Brother Jeremiah, let's discuss this, sir. What is your assessment of youth in America? Talk to us about the youth in America.
Youth in America are maturing prematurely, as I like to say. They're reaching certain levels of development way sooner than their mind, their mental or emotional or spiritual capacity can even handle. The reason is because they're being exposed to so many different things at an earlier age than any other generation ever did before, ever has before. because of the access from technology and social media and YouTube and the stuff that they see on TV, things have changed. And also the parental methods or the parenting styles have also changed over the years. So there's not really much guidance or supervision over the things that the children are watching, the things that they're doing on their phones, at homes, at their friend's house. That's one thing that has changed. The village, when I was growing up, there was a village. It wasn't just my parents that I had to answer to. Anybody else that my parents were friends with or was in the neighborhood or in the church, they were able to correct us, and we knew that we had to listen. And if they corrected us, most likely they would let my parents know that they had to correct us, and then my parents would correct us again. So it was a village that was raising the children as well. So that also goes with like the supervision. There's not much adult supervision anymore for many different reasons. One thing that I noticed the most working in the school arena, the respect for authority has decreased tremendously. They have little to no respect for authority, and partially because that there is no real authoritative figure in their house or in their home. They don't have no real authority to answer to in their daily life outside of school. So when they come to school, it's hard to listen to someone telling me what to do, because that's not normal for me. And then let alone having a strong Black male telling me what to do. A lot of these children, they don't have fathers. They don't have father figures. They don't have a male role model, a male figure. So it's we have a lot to deal with, a lot of pushback, a lot of attitude, a lot of who are you talking to? Well, I'm talking to you because I'm the teacher and you're the student. I have to tell you what to do in order for you to be successful. Also another thing is they're extremely, extremely sensitive now. You got to be careful what you say, how you say it. You've always had to be careful what you say, how you say it, but even more now because the sensitivity is increased. A lot of kids will go home and try and twist your words around and say that you said something or say it in a way when you didn't even really mean it that way. So we have to be careful with that. Not only are they sensitive, but so are some parents now. You really have to be careful in how you correct students and the things that you say to students. Society as a whole, I feel, has moved further and further away from God, and the disobedience is at an all-time high. So whenever you see that, you know, there are going to be a whole bunch of problems that follows that. And I always think about how that verse says the wages of sin is death. And so when you look at disobedience and sin of disobedience, I think about the death that we encounter in our communities, not even just like your life, like physical death. I'm thinking about mental death, emotional death, and spiritual death. And I start to think about the diagnosis of the children now is at an all-time high. You have so many kids being diagnosed with different types of disorders and getting IEPs and all of this stuff because they have this diagnosis and they supposedly have this disorder, but there's so much going on mentally and emotionally. And that's a byproduct of us moving further and further away from God. And so that's my assessment for children in America, children where I'm teaching at, what I see on a daily basis. These are the things that I'm seeing that's affecting the way that they're growing up and their behavior and the things that they do and the way that they think.
Yes, sir. Now, let me ask you two kind of micro questions in the midst of what you're saying. Every point that you made was excellent. I just pray that the Holy Ghost is touching many who are watching or will be watching even after the broadcast is finished. I want to ask you about the senior staff in the school system, okay? Because we're talking about the children, you know, in terms of this kind of hypersensitivity. Do you believe that the senior staff as well has a type of hypersensitivity? Because what happens a lot of times is you have sensitivity coming from the children, but you also have it coming from the senior staff. And as a teacher, you kind of get wedged in between. Have you noticed that? Any in your experience?
They will have an idea or ideas of the way that they think that things should be done, not realizing that times have changed and the way to reach this generation now is not the way that you reach the generation that you've taught before. Respect the fact that you have been teaching for so long, that you have this much experience, but times have changed. Children are not the same anymore. And so when you do speak up against that, like I said, you have to be careful. It's delivery. I'm learning that a lot. You can disagree, mm-hmm. but it's the way you disagree. And if you disagree
right.
in a way that can be offensive, you have to deal with what comes with that. You know, and if it's somebody who's in leadership, sometimes you may have to deal with them acting funny and doing certain things that affects you in a certain way. You know, it's kind of messed up, but it's the reality of what goes on in the schools. And you're talking about the senior people in the school who often hold leadership roles, or even senior teachers who are teaching. But yes, it's the sensitivity all across the board.
Yeah, and that brings about Sister Lakeithia Lockridge. We thank the Lord for you, ma'am. It saints, please continue to share. If you believe somebody needs to be in this discussion and in this service, please type their names in the chat directly, so tag them so we can invite them into the service. That's so critical what you're saying, Brother Jeremiah, because what happens is, I wanted to kind of have you point that out, because what happens is it creates a cyclic concoction when there's too much emotionalism and sensitivity. Number yeah. one, solutions to problems break down. And then number two, what happens is everybody starts to get burned out. Okay. And so that leads me to the second, that leads me to my second kind of micro question. What have you noticed is the effect upon teachers when there's this kind of high sensitivity? Have you noticed any effect on the teachers in your experience?
Well, you talked about the burnout. And to be fair, the areas I'm seeing it in is with coworkers and colleagues and peers. So same age, people that we work with, sensitivity and things like constructive criticism. We see you not doing something right and we got to correct it, because at the end of the day, we have to do the best that we can in order to teach these children and to give them the tools that they need in order to be successful when they leave from this school. So if you're doing something wrong, we have to let you know, whether you're a new teacher or you're an experienced teacher. You know, it's constructive criticism. We're all here to help each other. It's nothing personal on that end. But also in dealing with scholars, I will say this, like I said, to be fair, we're dealing with a different generation and a different type of child now, where they speak their mind. They're not afraid to say what's on their mind. The behaviors are different than when I grew up. We would try and say things on the low if we weren't really disrespectful to teachers, because we knew we would get in trouble when we got home. So we weren't disrespectful. But now, like I said, there's no respect for authority. So the burnout there is having to deal with the scholars that are disrespectful. But across the board, what I've learned is not to take anything personal. You can't take this stuff personal, because scholars don't even know you. You know what I'm saying? And they're responding that way because, like I said, they don't have any authoritative figures that they have to answer to on a regular basis outside of school. So when they come here, of course, they're going to push back. All right. They're doing what we expect them or should expect them to do. But we have to stand up and be strong and be secure in ourselves as teachers to still hold them to that standard. Yes, I understand. But you have to stay in your seat and you have to be silent, because I have to teach you. And if everybody decides to get up and starts to talk, then nothing happens here. Like, nobody learns. I can't teach you. There's nothing productive about this. But in certain cases, if you don't know not to take stuff personal, or I could go even deeper, and you don't understand that you're not up against the child, but the spirit in the child.
Yes.
You don't have that knowledge. You will go in there and you will burn out a lot faster because emotionally they're tearing you apart. And then what shortly after that, what shortly follows is the mental deterioration. Now, mentally, you're checked out. You don't want to be in the classroom anymore because there's too much to handle. And if you are a sensitive person to begin with, that just adds on to it. And it's tough to be in that type of environment and to try and teach.
Yeah, teaching is definitely not for the faint of heart, for sure. And, and if you have a hypersensitivity, you might want to find another field because it's like that in ministry, too, by the way. You know, many people don't realize you can't be hypersensitive in ministry. Matter of fact, anytime you're serving the public, you're serving any. I found that that's also true as being a husband and a father and a leader of my home, that you can't take things personally, even when your family members are having a bad day. So I to your point, Brother Jeremiah, I think that works all across the board for our lives in general. There, and you're absolutely right. There seems to be a hyper emotionalism in our country now. And it's something that, you know, and I'm going to tell you where you can see it now. Back in the day, if you were watching like a news broadcast or you were watching a documentary that was in an interview style, kind of like we're doing now, and you were asked a question, the first two words most of the time out of a person's mouth, whether they were male or female, is, well, you know what I think? I think, I think, I think, I think. Now we've changed. And if you watch most of the broadcast now, or you're listening to just regular conversations in society, everything is, I feel, I feel. Even our slang is, you feel me, you feel me. We never said stuff like that when I was growing up, you know? So it's like, everything is feeling now. And the problem with feelings is they oscillate, they vacillate, erratic. We need rational, logical thinking for problem solving and for and for gaining solutions. So I love everything that you're saying because I'm really so glad you're bringing this out for us, because many people, I'm going to tell you right now, and I really even hate to say this in a sense. Now, I'm a crazy preacher, so I'll say whatever the Holy Ghost command me. But this from a personal sense, I hate to even have to say this, but there are adults that haven't learned this yet, Brother Jeremiah. There are grown adults much older than you, maybe even twice, three times your age, and they go through their whole life, they don't learn this, and what happens is you're miserable. And I think that's what's really happening in our schools. There's a level of miserability because the emotionalism is too high. And what's happening is the teachers, you know, I was sitting with a bunch of teachers one time in Albany, and I said, really, you know, we're teachers, but now these days you got to be part psychologist, part preacher, you know, rabbi, part, you know, whatever. It's like you got to wear a few hats to get these kids taught, you know, but I'll tell you this, and this is what I love that you pointed out. There's been a breakdown of discipline. See, when I was going to school, your teacher could whoop you. I don't mean paddle your rear end. I mean, whoop it. Okay. Your neighbor could spank your rear end. Mm-hmm. Yeah. First lady's right here. She knows. All of us older saints, we know. I got Pastor Dr. Rhonda with us and Bishop Harold, Pastor Sheba.
Bring that back.
Come on. They need to bring it back. And that's why you didn't talk back in school, because the talking back had a consequence. And the consequence was your little red rear. I remember one time Pastor Dr. John Hagee here, right here in San Antonio, he said, a little kid said, Daddy, will you get me a little red truck if I'm good? He said, no, I'll get you a little red rear if you're not. That needs to come back in our churches and in our schools, you know? And so, Dr. Rhonda said, I'm ready to collect child support for some of these parents. Come on, I'm with you, Doc. I'm telling you. And I'm going to tell you right now, I would collect it and send it to Brother Jeremiah, because this is getting crazy, you know. But I'll tell you this.
It's tough.
I thank the Lord. I'm going to tell you, Brother Jeremiah, because I used to be right at LaSalle as a residential counselor. And here's what happened. Now, here's another echelon, too, that we don't think about. Laws make the system harder, too, because when I was at LaSalle, they started to change the state laws that begin to make it reasonable for children to accuse you. Now you go from maybe a slap on the wrist, a suspension from the job, to being in jail. So I actually resigned. I left. I said, I'm not going to jail for these kids. I'll take a day off. But now you're saying they have changed the laws now where I can go to jail. No, thank you. And I left. And that's what sent me to the university. I said, you can keep that. I'm not going to jail over your crazy kids that the parents aren't doing their job. I'm not going to do it. Now, I thank the Lord at LaSalle, because what we did, we called the parents in, and then I understood why the children were crazy like they were, because the parents were. I'm sitting there talking to the parent. The parent wants to argue and fight, and I'm not having it, and I'm saying, you work. But when their child came in, here's the key, teachers. When the child came in, I had the child's attention. So now the parent is looking, the child goes home, and the child was saying, how come you're so good for Mr. Cox? You listen to him, but you don't listen for me. Now they come back. They want to ask me. Now, here's the problem, teachers. Here's the problem, parents. Many of you are telling your children what to do, but you're not leading out front. You're not showing them. You're not showing them. That's the problem. We need to show our children what to do. See, I'm going to tell you, Brother Jeremiah, we had a chore list, right? So I gave each and every... Now, we got 20-some guys in there, right, young men? I gave each and every one a chore, but guess which one I took? Non-negotiable. And they came in one day. They said, Mr. Cox, we're looking at the list, but there's nobody to clean the bathroom. I said, yeah, there is. You didn't look far enough down on the list. My name was next to the latrine, next to the bathroom. Okay. So for the whole time I'm there, I cleaned their bathroom. We got all these urinals and stalls. My chore was to clean the bathroom. I led from out front. See, I led from out front. Then the staff started doing that. Then guess what? I started working with others. We went from the number one restraining facility to the bottom. We became the number one facility for troubled youth in New York State. You call Troy Kennedy, you call Frank Walcott, Frank Hunziker, call them all. They're all there. And I'm telling you, they will tell you, we went from the number one facility for jacking kids up down to the bottom. To nothing. We became the number one facility in New York State simply by changing the discipline. Parents, we need discipline. So many parents, and that's a pet peeve of mine. You sit down on the couch, you tell the child to go do. I led my children from out front. That was the difference. My parents led from out front. My mother didn't tell you to go do something. She told you to come go with her. My father didn't tell you to go do something. He told you, come on, put your shoes on. I'll meet you outside. We have to start leading from the front again. And Brother Jeremiah, I know that you do. All right, let's get into our next question. What is your assessment? Now, we talked about in America, and you gave us an excellent assessment, because there's a lack of discipline. There's a breakdown across the board. We got high charged emotionalism in the environments of school. And of course, it's even more charged because now, you know, everybody has in the back of their mind, I want to be safe when I go now, because, we hardly ever heard of a teacher getting hit or anything. You know, we were coming up in schools, now they're doing it right and left. And I'm going to be honest with you, I don't play that kind of stuff. So I probably would be down at the jail. Thank the Lord I'm preaching now, not teaching, because I'd probably be in jail, because I don't do hands on me. Okay. Now, I'm not suggesting any of you do that. I'm just saying that the Lord has to deal with me, because I'm not buying it. Okay. Now, let me ask you this, Brother Jeremiah, y'all pray for me. Let me ask you this. What is your assessment of youth in the church? Let's go inside the church now. Inside the church. What's your assessment of the youth in the church? Because I asked that, Brother Jeremiah, and let me point this out to everybody who may not know. Brother Jeremiah's father, Dr. Paul, was for many years, there's Wilborn Temple up there, First Church of God in Christ. He was for many years the youth pastor. So he not only has this in him, in his own right, but he comes from a lineage of this, okay? So he has a unique perspective. Brother Jeremiah, give us your assessment of youth inside the church.
All right, so I will start with the first word that comes to mind is disengaged. I often see
that's good.
They're there. Also, the number from when compared to when I was in church and I was youth, to as compared to now, is a lot less. There's not as much youth in church as there was when I was going on. I'll start there. So the number is smaller. And the ones that are there, I see a majority are disengaged. They'll be in there, but they're either talking to their friend or some of them have phones. So, you know, they're on the phone. They're not really engaged in the service. Some of them are bored. You know, I only come probably because my parent made me come. Or I come because my uncle or my aunt dragged me. Somebody dragged me here. I had to be here. So that's why they're there. But there's also like an age gap there. There's something missing. So in certain churches, you'll see that there's a whole bunch of young people. Then there's old people. But that young adult area is missing. A lot of young adults. Now, when I was growing up, those are the ones that I looked up to. And the reason why I wanted to come to church, because I was going to see somebody that was, they're older than me, but they're closer in my age. So I can relate a little bit. You know what I'm saying? And I'll listen to them because I want to be like you. You know, right. So when you tell me like this is right and this is what I should be doing, and I see you praising, I see you worshiping, I see you on the praise team, I see you in the choir as a youth, I want to do that. You know, but that's another thing that's missing in the church now. There's not many, at least I can't speak for all of America, but just this area, my age group, it's not many of us in churches right now. So there's like a gap that's missing for the youth to look up to and to want to be like and to be an example for them. I know some of them have questions. It's another thing when I think about the youth in the church. They have questions that need real answers. You know, somebody that can actually answer their questions and be real with them and not give them like a cookie cutter answer, but a real answer to their questions. And some of them know what's right because they're in the church and they hear the gospel and they hear the truth, but they want to know why it's right and how can I apply this to my life? A lot of us will hear, you got to do this, you got to do that, and don't do this, and don't do that. I'm blessed to have the pastor that I have and to have the parents that I have because I grew up knowing why. Right. I didn't just know what. I knew why we don't do Incredible. These things.
Yes, sir.
So it kind of decreased my inquisitive nature. You know, as a kid, you're going to be inquisitive. You're going to be curious. But I know why. So if I still go and I decide to do this, that's just me. You know, that has nothing to do with what I wasn't told or me trying to figure things out. I already know what's right, what's wrong, and why it's wrong, and why this is right. And not only that, but I know how to apply it to my life, and I know what that looks like. The youth now are probably missing a consistent example of what it is to live and to be holy. And I'm not saying that we were perfect or my parents were perfect, but one thing that did not change was we were always in church. Whenever there was church, we were there. They did not live a double life. What the person they were in church was who they were at home.
True.
And we consistently went. There was no, oh, we're there for one season, then we're gone. The next season, we were always in church. We were trained and raised in the church.
Yes, sir.
But one of the things one of the biggest things I think is missing, the youth need to understand the difference between religion and relationship and the importance of the relationship. That's the most important part, is building a relationship with God. And in building Yes. that relationship with God, you will start to do different things. You'll think differently. You walk differently. You talk differently. You do the things that God wants you to do because of where your relationship is. And that's why we do and we don't, because of our relationship. It's in being, not in our doing. And in our being, our doing will become more effective.
Yeah, and you know, it's so critical what you're saying, Brother Jeremiah, in that first paradigm you gave when you talk about the older people and the younger people, and there being a gap. Now, what has happened is, and some of you guys are a little too young to have, you may have discovered this if you talk to the older generation, but I was with the brothers in a past discussion, and the younger gentleman who was of Generation Z, I asked him why that paradigm was the way it was. He didn't really know. But this is what I shared with them, and this is what the problem is. There's a generation missing because, one, when you talk about the breakdown in the home, what happened is the age group that you're referring to is going to be your 30-year-olds right now. It's basically going to be your millennials, kind of the lower end of your millennials, going a little bit backwards towards Z. Okay, so that's the group we're talking about right in there. And the problem is, many families were torn apart by drugs, both in the black and white communities. Many were torn apart by divorce. And there was a shift in America nationally away from the word of the Lord. Okay, so now we got folks they have replaced church with, you know, temples, with synagogues, with different places, with mosques. And so they're sending their kids over here to the church, but they're not coming. And then many of them, another thing that destroyed church attendance is, there was a time, you know, in the upstate area, I'll use that area for example, you take all the barbers in the area, there was a pact between the barbers that you were closed on Sunday and Monday so you could go to church. That same principle was in America. Many of the patriarchs in business, you didn't work on Sunday. That was a day of rest for your family. Now, what you decide to do with it, whether you went to church or not, that wasn't their concern, but they gave you the day, and that was throughout the corporate business world, all right? So it didn't matter what echelon, most companies gave you Sunday off so you could go to church. There was Family Hour on TV, and that was written into our laws. So that kept the Playboy channels out and all the filth and perversion out. And then Mr. Rogers, there's a famous video where he went to lobby on the Congress floor for that reason. Okay, so what happened is, once that was removed, now all the filth came on TV. There was a time you didn't even hear a strong shoot on TV. You didn't hear a strong darn on TV. Like, it was completely pure. You didn't hear anything on there or see anything. Now everything goes, right? And so our kids are being exposed to that, which is going to translate right into the church, right into the schoolhouse, right? And every other tapestry in society, right? So there's been a breakdown. Now, the issue is that age group is missing largely because they're the ones referred to as the unchurched generation. The millennials were the first generation where there was a breakdown in the structure of church. Now, Z, they're saying that the millennials started to be atheistic, but Gen Z, they're speaking a death over them, saying that they're completely godless. There's no God in them, right? And that's what happens when you remove the God of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, whose son is Jesus Christ, from the spiritual tapestry of any nation. Now, Psalms 9, and we've been heralding this for some time, Psalms 9 says that the 9 and 17 says, the wicked shall be turned into hell. Now, hell there is translated as the Hebrew word Sheol, which means the place of the dead. Now think about that. So the scripture reads this way: the wicked shall be turned into the place of the dead, and every nation that forgets God. So our nation now has become the place of the dead, both spiritually, and now it's starting to be physically, because the spiritual will be undone first, then the physical will come undone, right? They're a coalescing of each other. One succeeds the other one. So now the problem is, now here's what we're concerned about, Brother Jeremiah, and the Holy Ghost is speaking to me right now, because we need to pray. We need to intercede, because here's the problem. The scripture speaks of a time, the prophet Amos speaks of a time that would come where there would be a famine, not of food and water, but of hearing the word of the Lord, right? America is on the brink of that. I'm going to tell you why, because I do know about other churches around the country, and I do know about other churches in the international community, and we don't see it primarily there. But in America, we have this gap. We don't have that gap there. They have the generations represented. We have it here in America, and it's setting us up for a fall. And I'm going to tell you what the fall is. When that older generation dies out, you got these young people who don't even want to be in church. They're going to leave. The church doors are going to close. You know what you have now? A famine of hearing the word of the Lord. And now what happens is the pastors who are holding tight, the scripture also says they will make themselves a prey for standing for righteousness. This is where we're headed if we're not careful. This is why all the churches, see, we got a bunch of pastors, and I'm going to speak now, and I'm not putting this on you. I can say this because I put skin in the game, but I'm going to say this. This is why all the pastors arguing and fussing with each other is nonsense. Okay, if we're serving the Lord Jesus Christ, now some are arguing because they don't have the Holy Ghost, but all of us that have the Holy Ghost, we need to stop the nonsense because we need to stand together. That's what the North American Watchman's Council is about. It's a free fellowship. I'm not here to tell the other pastors what to do, and they're not here to tell me what to do. But you know what we realize? If we don't stand together, no church is going to make it, because the more these church doors close, first of all, COVID closed a lot of church doors. The more they close, guess what's going to happen? It's going to put pressure on those of us who are still standing. The weight is going to become too much to bear. If we fold as the front line of defense, the nation plunges into godlessness. Now, you know what's terrible about that? The Lord Jesus prophesied a time coming at the end of times, when the iniquity would abound so fiercely, the love of many will wax cold. Any nation that is void of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, whose son is Jesus Christ, becomes a nation where iniquity begins to abound. Then none of our families are safe. You understand? So when you look at pastors like your father, like myself, and like others, you better start worshiping the Lord. You better start interceding on our behalf, because if we buckle, the nation plunges into complete godlessness. Now, here's what happens. Let me give us a forevision, and I'm not prophesying now, but I am saying we have seen this before in scripture in Israel. Now, if the pastors fold and there's a famine in the land of hearing the word of the Lord, anybody that it goes on too long, especially if it goes one generation, and the longer it goes generationally, what happens is you reach another time the scripture speaks of. I believe it's in the prophet Jeremiah. You reach another time, and here's the problem. What starts to happen is that there's no teaching priest and no word of God anywhere. So the scripture says the nation plunges into utter darkness, to where every man does that which is in his heart, right? That's what happened in the days of Noah. And the Lord said their thoughts are only continuously evil. So he sacrificed everybody on the altar of holiness. He just sacrificed all of mankind, right? By water, baptism in water. The Apostle Paul had it right in the New Testament theology. So, Brother Jeremiah, our teachers are critical. Our pastors are critical. Our parents are critical, and working together is critical, because, sir, right now we are facing a famine in the land of hearing the word of the Lord. We have many churches. Does not mean the Spirit of the Lord and the word of the Lord is there. Why? Our churches don't preach against sin. They don't preach repentance anymore. They don't preach hell anymore. Now, hell, people are allergic to that preaching. They don't want to hear about hell, but it's in your Bible, and Jesus preached 2/3 more about hell than he did heaven. Any pastor that does not tell you need to repent, that preaches hellfire and brimstone, you need to repent before you go to hell. If you're being saved, what are you being saved from? Go ahead and tell me. What are we being saved from if it's not hell? If we have salvation and there's no consequence of hell, what is our salvation good for then? There's no penalty, so why would you need to be saved? Jesus said, I tell you, you fear, not the one after they killed your body can do no more, but after your body is dead can cast both your body and soul alive into hell. There was, when we grew up in the church, they preach hellfire and brimstone. Now the pastors are allergic to it, because you know what it is now? Many of them are hooked into the government's money. If we preach that, the government stops giving money, the church doors close. They don't trust the Lord. And then if we're not getting government money, we're getting the people's money. So if we preach hellfire and brimstone, then they won't give anymore, and the church doors will close. No pastor, very few pastors are trusting the Lord now. But I am telling you, we trusted the Lord. We've been preaching hellfire and brimstone, and no, we're not in a building, and no, we don't have a lot of money right now. But let me tell you something. This ministry right here is affecting people internationally. We are talking to people that if we started name dropping, people would be absolutely astounded. Brother Jarquise Marzavian Mitchell, we thank the Lord for you, sir, being with us on today. I'm not even going to say nothing. I'll let Bishop V correct me. I was going to say something, but I'll let him instruct me if it's what I'm thinking. He'll catch on to what I'm thinking. So let me say this. We need right now to pray for all of our pastors, all of our teachers, and we need to pray for righteousness and holiness to return to our nation, to our homes, and to our schools, and to our churches. Until Dr. John Hagee said many years ago, until the churches of America begin to thunder again, the Lord will not restore the nation. We have to cry loud, Isaiah 58:1, and spare not. We have to lift up our voices like a trumpet. We have to show the Lord's people their transgression in the house of Jacob, its sin. And then I like what Micaiah says. He says, the Spirit of the Lord. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me of judgment and of might to declare unto Jacob its transgression and to Israel its sin. We're running around. We want to prophesy, Brother Jeremiah. We want to see. I see this. I see this. We want to prophesy all these blessings and peace. But the Lord is saying, until they line up with my word, you're prophesying, Jeremiah, the 23rd chapter, you're prophesying peace to a people that despise me. We have to change the fact that we despise the Lord in this country, and then it will change all the systems of our country, including the school system. Saints, now more than ever, I'm talking to all the prayer warriors and intercessors now, we have to pray for the Lord, for this country to receive its God again, or it is not going to get better. It's going to get far worse. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you right now, and teachers will go to school. They're hazarding themselves right now. They're praying right now. Come on. The pastors are in churches now. They're praying. People are shooting up churches. They're shooting up schools. We have become a prey now who are standing on the front line simply because the nation has rejected God. Our nation is turning in to the place of the dead. You want to know why so many young people are dying? Because it's becoming the place of the dead. America is right here. Now, you know why that concerns me? Because I have children here and grandchildren. Right. Your baby girl is here now. See, it's different when you're watching your parents than when you are one. Brother Jeremiah is finding that out now. It's much different. See, when it's your parents, you're looking at their pain. When it's you, you're walking in their pain. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. Wow. Come on. You're walking in their pain now. So now you start to understand this is why dad and mom did this, not be for themselves. Yeah. They were concerned about me. See, it everybody thinks they can do it until it's time for you to do it. And you find out it's not as easy as we make it look. Everybody thinks they can pastor and preach, Brother Jeremiah, until we give them the mic. Now, all of a sudden, they're like, that's all, folks. Yeah, it looks easy while Dr. Parsons and I are doing it. But then when you have to do it, it's a different story, right? Yeah. And so we have to understand this. Okay, Brother Jeremiah, I love what you're saying. Let me ask you this, since we're on that. If you were going to fix this generational gap, if we were going to fix this, now we know we need prayer, because until you fix it in the realm of the spirit, it's not going to get fixed in the natural. Is there anything that we can do from your assessment in the church to try to help our youth with this age gap until the Lord restores? He'll restore, okay, he'll restore, but is there anything that we can do in the meantime until he does, naturally speaking? We know we got to pray, but is there anything in your assessment that we might be able to do for our youth naturally?
Part of the disengagement is because they're not a part of. I often critical. Think about how we had second Sunday, that was Youth Sunday. Now, I don't think that's good enough for the youth that we have. They have to be a part of. I'm not necessarily saying every Sunday has to be their Sunday. That's not realistic. Second Sunday, this is good. The choir's going to sing. They're going to do some things. We might have an inspirational speaker, but they need to have something to do every single Sunday, whether that's shadowing an usher, shadowing the media ministry, sitting up in the choir stand with the adults while they're singing with that choir, instead of just, oh, I'm going to come to church and I'm just going to sit here. I'm going to watch them do everything. Even if it's something as simple as them going up to the offering table and them standing with the deacons or the people just standing there.
Oh, yeah. So critical.
Collecting the offering, so stuff like that. But they have to be involved. They have to have a reason to want to come other than I'm just coming because I made to come. it'll change to I'm coming because, oh, I want to usher today. I want to carry the offering pan. I want to sit in the media booth and see how they control the Facebook Live. I want to learn how to do that. I want to learn how to change the volume of the mics and take the highs out and fix the feedback. Stuff like that, giving them something to do, making them excited to come. Also, things to do outside of just Friday night youth group, having fellowships, help them understand that it's more than just, you know, church. We want to build a relationship, you know, and get to know you as well. We care about you. I'm not saying that just being in church means you don't care about you, but it's just a different type of fellowship when you can all also come together and go out. My youth group, we went to the mall and we had a bigger turnout. And then in that turnout, we were able to bring them back into the church because we had to go outside of the church and get them interested into something that normally would not happen inside of the church. So doing more events like that, having just stuff for them to do, because there's always something for them to do outside of church every single day. You know what I'm saying? So yes, we sir. Have to involve them more and come up with more events for them to do. But the best thing that we can do for them is live the life that we're teaching, live the life that we're preaching consistently.
Come on, Brother Jeremiah.
You know, because we can involve them and we can do all of these events and all this stuff. But the thing that's going to make the difference is us living the life that we're supposed to be living, holy, doing things God wants us to do, because then they'll see the power of doing that. They'll see the benefits of living for Christ. They'll see all that stuff and they'll see, oh, this is what it's like. This is why I'm supposed to do that. This is why I'm supposed to pray and I'm supposed to read and supposed to fast. They're not too young to fast. They can fast as well.
Oh, not at all. Yes, sir.
But that number one, I should have started with that. That number one, and being an example and sharing with them, like I said, the why. This is why. It's not just about doing. Well, why am I doing this? You know, like I said, this generation, they're not afraid to ask why. But we can't be afraid to tell them the why.
Right, that works in our favor.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And then we can't think of it as disrespect. It's not disrespectful for them to ask why. Maybe sometimes the way that they do it, like I said, delivery is very important. But the act of them asking why, we should be happy because they want an understanding. The Bible says, with all thy getting, get an understanding. It's the understanding that makes the difference.
Yes, sir.
That's what's going to make you want to do what you're supposed to do.
Difference.
You know, so you get a different result when you're doing something that you're supposed to do because you're just doing it just because I have to. For example, all right, I like to lift. I like to work out. But I'm going to have a better workout when I want to be there. You know, I'm not just going there because, all right, I know I got to go there. No, I want to be there. So I'm going to give it everything that I have. And I know why I'm doing this.
Right.
You know, so when you know why, you're prone to give more of yourself and give a better effort. And the better effort that I'm talking about in regards to the youth is living for Christ. Why am I supposed to live for Christ? Well, I know the why. Not only I know why, but I see an example from my parents or from the older people that I look up to. So being that consistent example of living holy and living for Christ, until God, like you said, repairs that bridge or that gap. Because what can happen is, even if, you know, that generation never comes back, the ones that are there now, the youth, they will grow up and they'll be that bridge for the youth coming behind them. Because we decide to be consistent and show them the way. Not only show them the way in word, but also in deed, in life, consistency.
Yeah, and Brother Jeremiah, so critical what you said. And it shows us, if we reverse that a little bit, it shows us from whence we've fallen. Because when we grew up in the church, exactly what you describe as a paradigm, we served with the deacons. We were at the we were ushering with the ushers. We were I learned how to play the drums very well by sitting with the drummers. and watching the older drummers drum, right? And then my and then sitting with Deacon Lee and them, they were the guitar players, and I learned a few chords. My father played the guitar, and I think the most critical thing is my father's a preacher like yours, and so I know how you guys are raised. We were raised the same way because both of our fathers are preachers, and I travel with my father because he was an evangelist, and that's why I evangelize. It's no mystery. If I saw him doing it, it's in my spirit. It gets in me. The Holy Ghost got in me. And so when I give my life to the Lord, these things come out of me the same way they're coming out of you now, because you were with your father. You travel with your father. You saw what your father and mother did, you know? And so that's so critical. So what happened is now we have a breakdown because the older generation started to leave. And what has happened now, my generation, Generation X, and we have the baby boomers, we are all your 50 and 60 year olds now. And so when I was with the brothers, I said, listen, we have to step up to the plate now because the millennials and Gen Z behind us, we are going to have to step up to the plate here. See, the gap happens, and the young man that we were talking about, he happens to be a prophet that's in Gen Z. The issue is he didn't understand how we got there. He knows we have an unchurched generation, but doesn't understand how we got there. And so we explain that. That's another topic. But the principle in it is the same. When there's a breakdown up top, it is automatically going to flow to the bottom. And so now what the Lord has to do, this is why we need to pray, and it's exactly rightly what you said. He will have to raise up a generation where he encounters them directly, but that's not the way he desires to do it. The way he desires to do it is a blessing passes generationally. But when there's a generational gap, what the Lord will do is encounter a generation in their dreams, in their visions, to bring them to the forefront. He doesn't desire to do that, but he will. But when he has to do that, that means somebody failed. And when we stand before him, it's going to come back to us. It's going to come back to bite us. Okay, so I have made up in my mind not to be one of those that doesn't take what's in me and pass it to the younger generations. You know, it's I love all these new songs and everything. But yesterday, Brother Jeremiah, in our International Prophetic Bible Study, we had an old spiritual that came up in my spirit in the morning. You know, he did not have to do it, but he did. Woke me up this morning, started me on my way. Now, if I decide not to pass that to the younger generations, we have a spiritual that may go out of the earth. But you know how that was transferred for me? It comes way down through my family line to me. So I sung these songs before my children, and all of you who are in your 20s that are singing these songs, they were passed to you because you're too young to have gotten them on your own. But here's what the Lord would have to do. If we fail to pass, then he's got to encounter a generation. You know what happened? They'll start writing these hymns and saying, I just got something new from the Lord, and not know that three generations before them, that was the standard in the church. And that's what the shame is. They won't even know it. They'll think it's something brand new, and they won't know that's actually your heritage. You know, Isaiah 54 and 17 talks about this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me. Well, we lose that if we don't stand up and do what we're supposed to do in our generation. And I'm going to tell you something, Brother Jeremiah, the Lord spoke to me directly, spoke to me and said, son, your generation, okay, and your father's generation, my father is the silent generation, I'm Generation X, then the boomers are in between us. He said, every one of you need to begin to focus on the youth and pour into the youth what's in you. And he said, I will do two things if you will obey me. Number one, I will give you an extension of life. And number two, you won't want for anything while you're in that extension of life. You won't want for a single thing, but it's conditional. We must focus our ministry and our time and our hearts on the youth. So here we're focused on the youth. We've had the youth on with us multiple times. We have you on, you're of the younger generation. And we're focused on the youth. And let me say this, the good news is we do see revival happening in various places where the older leadership is starting to focus on the youth, because we're not the only ones the Lord talked to about this, right? And so we're starting to see a focus on the youth. Now, in the international community, like in Africa, there are many orphans. There are many that lost both parents. Well, what happens to them if we don't step up and decide? I've always said this, and I've always demonstrated this. I'm more than just a father to my biological children. I'm a father to every young person that stands in front of me. So you said it earlier. You alluded to it earlier when you said it takes a village to raise. See, and that's what used to be, and we have to return. See, the prophet Jeremiah said, return to the old paths. He said, I'm making you, Jeremiah, restore of the breach and of the old paths to walk in. Saints, we got to return to the old paths of righteousness and holiness when it comes to our youth. I love everything you're saying, Brother Jeremiah. Now, let's go a little deeper here, all right? And I love how you took us into the deep revelation of this thing, because again, until we move it in the realm of the spirit, nothing's going to happen in the earth realm. But what I love that the Lord Jesus taught his disciples, Father, your will be done where? In earth as it is in heaven. Now, Brother Jeremiah, here's the problem. They translated that on earth, but the King James doesn't say on earth, because it has to be done in earthen vessels. Then it will translate into the earth realm. So when he said in earth, he's talking about in you first, in earthen vessels, then we will carry it out in the earth realm. But the first earth it has to happen in is us. So when the little slick translators who think they're smarter than the Holy Ghost came along, they said on earth as it is in heaven. No, it has to happen in you first. We want to talk about getting in the depth of the revelation, Holy Ghost, get it done in you first, then we'll carry it out in the earth realm and everybody will benefit. That's why we need righteous and holy pastors that don't just preach heaven. You have to preach hell. If you're telling people they need to be saved, that's one of the problems. Hardly any preachers are telling everybody they need to be saved now. But I'm going to tell you something. What I rejoice in, there are preachers that the Lord is bringing off the backside of the desert. There are preachers he's raising up right now. And I grew up, I'm going to tell you something, Brother Jeremiah. I didn't just grow up with great preachers and pastors. We grew up with great bishops and pastors in Detroit that preach hellfire and brimstone. And I'm telling you, we're shaking even pastors loose now. The way we preach Eric Cox community is shaking leaders loose all over the international community. It's shaking, I mean, and many of them are even coming against us. We're shaking them loose because what you've been doing is you've been building your brand. You have not been building the kingdom of God. Come on in the fire power of the Holy Ghost. You've been building your brand. You have not been building the kingdom of God. And now he sent prophets to check your spirit, to check your church, to check your brand, to tell you to put it down before you go to hell. I'm going to tell you right now, every pastor listening to this broadcast, if you're building your brand, you're going to end up in hell. Go check the scriptures and check the record and check the Holy Ghost. You need to build the kingdom. What is the kingdom? The kingdom is in the hearts of men. The Lord said, we are ambassadors of the Lord Jesus Christ. What are we carrying? The message of reconciliation. God is reconciling the world to himself through us. Come on. And pastors, if we're teaching and preaching any other thing, I assure you, and I'm going to tell you something, Brother Jeremiah, and everybody listening, and many of you, everybody at Cox Community Church knows, the Lord has given me the sight of a seer, and the Lord has allowed me to look into hell, and I have seen pastors there, bishops there, some of yours there, and you don't know it because they can't return to tell you. And some of you that are playing with the Lord's commission and you don't want to go out and tell people about Jesus Christ. He didn't tell us to go into all the nations and tell them about your church name. Go into all the nations and tell them about your Gucci Prada and your Neiman Marcus and your little Louis Vuitton and all that. He said, go into all the nations and tell them whatsoever I have commanded you, and don't take any thought what you'll say. It'll be given to you in the hour you go. So now you can't even preach your own message, which many pastors are doing. You're preaching, you're doing your little sermons. We don't sermonize over here. What we preach comes, the Father is speaking right through us. That's what it means to be an oracle. It's in your Bible. Let's check the record. We are oracles for the Lord. I don't sermonize. I don't have 92 pages of precast sermons. Mm-hmm. Oh, let's just pick one today. Any, many, mighty, yep, that looks good. Let's roll some dice and see what we're going to say to the people today. No, when I'm preaching the stuff I'm saying right now, the Holy Ghost is speaking to me. That's your bottom dollar, he is. And I'm telling you, I know, because a whole lot of folks are getting touched right now. And some of you, it's not rubbing you the right way, but you need that conviction of the Holy Ghost. All right. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you can't say it to your pastor, what do I say all the time? Take me, turn me on, and let me say it to your pastor, because I ain't scared of nobody. When you talk about a vet, let me tell you something, Brother Jeremiah. We came to that upstate area. We left, and then there were pastors and apostles and preachers talking about, what are we going to do about the Tri-City area? What are we going to do? You know the way. But take them suits off, them cute little suits, and put on your clothes, your street clothes, and let's go in the street and preach the unadulterated gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You want to take any city back? Let me tell you something. The apostles took the whole Roman Empire back by preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The whole Roman Empire ended up in Christian believing faith because the apostles preached. They shut down every false god. They shut, and then eventually the empire was destroyed. Come on in the firepower of the Holy Ghost. This gospel we have is all powerful. If the author of it is all powerful, then his word is all powerful, right? So, Brother Jeremiah, let's go deeper. We're almost to the end here, sir. Now, we've been talking about the youth in church, the youth in America, what's going on at home. Brother Jeremiah, talk to us a little bit about the correlation between all of those, how one affects the other, or do you believe one affects the other? And if so, what is the effect that these three have when it comes to our youth?
Well, absolutely. You talked about how homes were torn apart for different reasons. Whether it be divorce, or they have lost a parent, or one parent is incarcerated, this affects the development of children. And in different stages of development, they're all important to make sure that they grow up into a healthy human being. And in certain stages of development, if they miss it, it may affect them mentally, it may affect them emotionally. Spiritually, definitely going to be affected. And you see this when they come into the schools. You see this when they come into the classroom. This affects them with their mental state. You may have some schizophrenic students. You may have students. A lot of what we're seeing now is different forms, ADD, ADHD, stuff like that. There was a study done years ago about students who have asthma, and a high percentage of them, the correlation or something that they had in common was that their father wasn't present. And my father often talks about that, and he talks about how, like, in the spirit realm, you can't breathe without the father. So how that's affected. And if you're dealing with all of this, even as adults, we have a hard time dealing with certain emotional disorders and mental disorders. Imagine what a child is dealing with when they're trying to deal with this stuff. So it makes it a lot harder for them to learn. And when you're talking about going to church, now the church should be a place where you can come and you can be healed. But that won't happen if the church is not operating under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. If God isn't there, and the word, the true word, isn't going forth, and the music ministry isn't really ministering, they're just performing, then nothing will begin to change. There will be no healing. There will be no transformation. There will be no change. Now, when it comes to, because I thought about when you talked about the training starting at home, and the listening and the obedience, that starts at home. My parents taught me how to sit down and to behave myself and things like that at home. And I knew when I went out in public that if I showed out in public, then there would be some type of consequence when I got home. There's no more consequences for kids now. People are afraid to spank their children. Like you said, there's certain laws that are put in place. CPS is more aggressive now than they were before. But the Bible, it tells us we spare the rod, we spoil the child. We're doing them a disservice by not correcting them. Now, not every child deserves to be spanked. You have to know your child. There are some children that you just need to talk to. You need to be very stern. You need to be consistent. No matter if it's a consistent spanking or consistent speaking to, you need to be consistent in either one. Because if you're not, they're going to think that they can get away with certain things. And that's going to trickle over into either the church, they sitting there running around, acting a fool in church, or in the classroom, where they're causing hell in the classroom. The teacher can't teach, and they're a big distraction because there's no discipline at home. And for some reason, we see discipline now as a bad thing. If you discipline your child, you're a bad parent. No, you're a great parent if you discipline your child. Because you're saving them from a lot of unnecessary problems and hurt. And you're saving yourself as well. Because if you don't discipline them now, they're going to be disciplined one way or another. And you'd rather it be you, because you love your child and you know that you're going to do it the right way. Well, hopefully you do it the right way. That's a whole other topic.
Rather than the COs doing it in prison.
Because, listen, they're going to be disciplined. They're going to be checked one way or another.
One way or another.
Rather, you check them earlier so that they know how to conduct themselves later. And when I talk about disciplining them the right way, some parents, and I've seen it, you only discipline them when they get in trouble. Then it's too late. It's too late. When I say discipline, it's not even discipline. You just lash out. That's not discipline. You're correcting them because you're angry. You're upset. When you do it, then more times than not, it's going to be done the wrong way.
So critical.
You know, you're frustrated. So you punch them in the face. Like that's all you're doing is creating an angry human being. That's all you're doing. Or you're hitting them all different types of ways. No, there's a belt and then there's a behind. The belt meets the behind and, you know, it drives the foolishness far away from the child. You know, that's one of my biggest fears growing up. I want that belt to touch my behind. I'm good. It came too short. I'm telling on myself. I don't know why you're telling on me. I did it. I'm sorry. I don't want no problems. But that discipline, it shaped my whole mindset and it affected the way that I behaved. There's no discipline, partially because of the generation that's parenting now is not healed from what happened to them as children. Maybe the way that they were corrected wasn't the right way. So they made a vow, I'm not going to do that to my children. But discipline, it is needed. And without discipline, you're just going to, it's going to be a whole bunch of wild asses running around, as my dad would say.
And they're running too.
Exactly. And then it makes it harder for the teachers, because how dare we discipline them when you don't discipline them? How are they going to listen to us when they don't listen to you?
That's good.
You want us to control your child. You can't even control your child. So what are we supposed to do? You know what I'm saying? Or we try to discipline a child, but you're worried about what the other children are doing to provoke your child. But listen. Things are going to happen in life. We can't control everything. The only thing we can control is how we respond to what happens. What I'm trying to help you understand is the way that your child responded was not appropriate and it wasn't correct. And their response was 10 times worse than what the other child did to provoke them. And to be clear, I did speak to the other child as well. But the way your child responded was totally inappropriate and not acceptable. But for me to correct a child is wrong. No, everybody has to be corrected. No, we're trying to develop healthy, mature individuals so they can grow up and be successful and have be able to contribute to society and to their communities. They're not going to be able to do that without any discipline.
Yeah, so true, Brother Jeremiah. And the word that you used is so key, and it came up twice. In two of the questions that you responded to, is consistency, to be consistent. so critical to be consistent across the board. Two last questions. What burdens you about our youth today? Anything in particular? I mean, we could pick a whole bunch out of what you said, but is there anything special in your mind, something that speaks to you often that burdens you about our youth? That keeps you praying, I should say.
It's a whole lot, because I see a whole lot every day. Like I said, the eighth graders that I have, I see a lot every single day. The conversations they're having, the things that they're into, what it's because. Like you said, the church isn't thundering, which means we're not loud enough. We're not aggressive enough about the truth and about the gospel. We're not going the extra mile to snatch these kids up and to make sure they're in a place where they can be fed the truth and where they could know that there's a different way. There's a better way to live, regardless of where you come from. You don't have to be a product of your environment.
So true.
But I think the biggest thing that bothers me is the no regard for authority. Like, I can just do whatever I want to do. Can't nobody tell me nothing. That's a bad place to be in, because there's a lot of people sitting behind bars right now because that's what they thought. You know,
that's what they thought.
I want to do. Can't nobody tell me nothing. I'm not going to get in trouble. I'm not going to get caught. There are people that are in the grave because they had that type of mentality. They're no longer here with us because that's what they thought. But what I want them to understand is that people telling you what to do is not necessarily a bad thing.
Right.
Especially us as teachers. We're here to help you. Like, I'm telling you this because I actually care about you and because I love you, whether you believe it or not.
Right.
I'm correcting you and I'm holding you accountable to a high standard because I care about you. I don't want you to go down the wrong path, because if I sit here and I let you do whatever you want to do, you're going to think that you can do that everywhere you go. And the truth is, there are rules set in place to keep you safe. We have systems and routines to make sure that our objective is completed. What's the objective? To make sure that you learn and that you have the skills that you need in order to be successful, not just in school, but in life. I tell them all the time, you're not going to remember what Frederick Douglass was talking about. You're not going to remember what Ida B. Wells was trying to expose. You're not going to remember such and such. But what you will not forget, what's going to stick with you, is the self-discipline that you've gained, is the interpersonal skills that you've gained, how to talk to people, how not to talk to people, how to read the room, how to read body language, how to read facial expressions, how to be able to go back and apologize to somebody when you said something that was offensive to them, even if you didn't mean it that way. Those types of things are the things that you're going to remember and that you're going to take with you when you're done with schooling, because you're not going to be in school all your life.
Right.
But you're going to need these skills in order to be effective and to be successful as an adult and as a young adult. So,
yeah. And that's so critical, because it's so critical that you said that, because they're not going to be in school all of their life. And I think it behooves us. I've preached this many times all over the place over 30 years, is that as we're raising up our youth, they're going to be living next door to you after a while. So it would behoove you to make sure you pour in. And that's why I always felt like I'm going to be a father to every young person that stands in front of me, because one day you may move right next door to me and I don't want a bunch of hooligans over there. I want somebody respectable. I care about respectability, you know. And I'll tell you, Brother Jeremiah, for me, a lot of young people, our mannerisms are key too, because a lot of young people, when I talk to them, I'll say, yes, sir. And they look at me like, did you just say sir to me? I sure did. You know why? Because the scripture tells me what I sow, that shall I also reap. It's a spiritual principle. So the reason, you remember when I talk to you guys when you're younger, yes, sir, I'm talking to you. I'm older than you. I got a few years on you. I'm not much younger than your father. And I would say, yes, sir, no, sir. And your father is the same way. So you know what's interesting? When anybody talks to you three, guess what it is? Yes, sir, no, sir, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am. Thanks. Because they modeled it before you. My children are the same way. They don't say yes, sir, and no, sir, because, you know, I per se taught that to them directly. They say it where I sat them down and say, okay, when somebody speaks to you, no, they say that because I say that to them. So they say that to everybody, and everybody meets them and said, and it's the same thing with you. Everybody that meets you says, oh, they're so respectful. They're so this, they're so that. Yeah, because we modeled it before them. And so it works whether you're parenting, whether you're a teacher. It can work in any ambit of influence. I've worked in so many different genres and ambit of influence to where I say yes sir, no sir, and others who are not used to saying that, they start saying it. Then it kind of catches on like wildfire. Then the whole environment changes, and then everybody has this commonality and respect. Believers, we are so powerful. The scripture says one can put 1,000 to flight and 2 10,000. That's not just spiritual. That's not just preaching. That's not just, it is, it's not just teaching. It's a commonality of, you know what we've forgotten, many of us? Many people don't know about class now, but when we were growing up, it was cool to be classy, to speak well, to treat people well. That's called class. We've lost class in our society. We've traded it for another C called crass. We're crass now. We're just vulgar, rude, brutal. There's no, you know, Brother Jeremiah, when we were growing up, there was even respect amongst enemies. We didn't shoot up the women and the children. The women and the children were off limits. We'd do whatever we want to each other because we're in the game. Now, these young heads, now they just shoot everything moving.
Everything. Yeah.
There was codes even in prison. Now the codes have gone out the window. Even the prisoners are complaining. There's no code amongst these young people, right? There were codes. You didn't do certain things or you got shanked. Now you don't know who to shank or whether to shank them at all because everything goes now. You don't know who. There's no clear lines now. So what happens? Society breaks down into confusion. Now, when it reaches the prisons, our nation's under judgment. We're in trouble. When the prisoners don't know whether they're coming or going, we're in trouble. When the evil people are complaining about the confusion, you know we're in trouble as a nation, all right? So, last question, Brother Jeremiah. We thank you for receiving our invitation and just hanging out with us and spend this time. We'll end on this positive note, okay? All of it's positive, you know, even the negative, we're taking positive because we know that. What is your hope for our youth in the future? That's a great question to end with. Holy Ghost gave me all these questions specifically for you, but that's the one he gave me in with. What is your hope for our youth for the future?
My hope for the youth is that they develop a heart for God. Not for clout, not for fame, not for anything other than just wanting God's glory to be revealed through their life, the life that they live. And I tell my young people, when God's glory is revealed through your life, whatever is for you will be for you. So if you are gifted in a certain area, and you're giving that gift back to God, and it's because you really love God, and that's what you want. If His will is for you to be famous and to be known all around the world or whatever, that is what's going to happen. But if that's what you're chasing, if that's the only thing you're chasing, if that does not happen, then you will feel unsuccessful. You will not want to do what God gifted you to do anymore. But if your focus is God and that's where your heart is, none of that other stuff matters. And that's where you'll experience true joy. And you won't just be happy because something is going on or things are going your way. Even when things aren't going your way, you'll still have a peace. You'll still have joy because your focus and your heart is really for God. And that's what I want them to understand. If that's your focus, life is going to be hard at times. But life will be hard all the time.
Right, right.
Even in the tough times, you'll experience the weight of it for a moment. But because of your relationship with God, you will understand that I can give him everything that I'm going through right now, and he can carry it. And he can bear it all. And I believe that I'm going to be all right. And my heart is really for God. I'm doing all of this for him anyway. So all things are going to work together for my good. So even the bad things, they're not happening to me. They're happening for me. So I just want them to really develop that relationship is what makes the difference. The relationship is what makes the difference.
Amen, Brother Jeremiah. It's made the difference for you, obviously, and clearly demonstrated by the Holy Ghost today. It's made a difference for myself, First Lady, and so many of you. Sister Ray Lynn, we just thank the Lord for you, ma'am. Bishop V said, many parents and teachers can learn from the wisdom dispensed from the man of God. We need more spirit-filled men and women that encounter our youth. So absolutely true. I'm going to put a heart on that. That's so true. And Dr. Rhonda asked, do you see them entering, talking about the youth, into, now, Dr. Rhonda, I'm choking on this question, but I'm going to ask the man of God anyway. Do you see them entering into romantic relationships in a dangerous manner? Now, as a preacher, I'm already aggravated by that question, but I'm going to let you take it, Brother Jeremiah, since you're on the hot seat, not me.
Yes. I see it often. Now, a little background about my educational career. I started in second grade. I did second grade for 4 years. And in my fifth year, I taught third and fourth grade, and then I taught sixth grade. That was my fifth year. Now I'm in my sixth year, and I'm doing eighth grade. I didn't see relationships really until I got to sixth grade, the middle school. But now it's on a different level in eighth grade. And to answer your question about dangerous, I feel like at this age, it's all dangerous. It's just different levels of danger. Because a relationship, you have to think about commitment to another person. You can't commit to another person. You don't even know who you are. But that's a whole different type of conversation for another time.
Brother Jeremiah, you about to preach.
These children have the wrong idea of what a relationship really is because they're being trained and they're being taught by the music they're listening to. And we all know how powerful music is. Music can change anybody's type of mood. It can change an atmosphere. Think this is how we do it. And then we're ready to party. You know what I'm saying? But then you can turn on. If I should stay, I'd only be in the way. And now we all sad and we crying and we thinking about somebody who passed away. But so it's just from 1 second to the next. But the music is infiltrating their minds, their spirits, their hearts, and it is affecting them in the way that they're thinking and what they expect a relationship to be. And I'm just glad to say it, they're giving up their bodies way earlier than any other generation that I, like, in sixth grade.
That's crazy. Yeah.
So by eighth grade, you imagine how many times they done did what they wasn't supposed to do. Who knows if their parents know? We don't know. Like I said, I hear it in the conversations, and they come to me, and I let them know. I keep it real. They know I'm going to tell you what's up. I'm not going to sugarcoat anything. You shouldn't be doing it at all because you're creating soul ties, and soul ties is something that you can't break easily. Something you got to be careful. Some of them won't. Only by the power of God will they be broken.
Yes.
Because of how you're doing it in a way you're doing it and at such an early age when you're still developing yourself mentally and spiritually, is very, very, very dangerous. My best advice to them is be single. Don't get into no relationship. Learn who you are. Learn what you want. You're not going to be the same person. And you're in eighth grade. You change every day. You're changing every day.
Right, right.
As you get older, the change will slow down and you'll be more stable. But because of where you are in your life right now, you're changing every day. Physical abuse, no, I don't. I've heard of maybe one situation like that, where the young man, he had some issues, abandonment issues. And so he had a girlfriend and she was talking about leaving and he ain't like that. So it was, but I don't, that's not the norm here where I'm teaching at. But
yeah, and I think Dr. Rhonda may also be asking about the teacher's experience in physical abuse, because I know when I was at Albany High, one of the students grabbed the English teacher and choked him with their necktie to the point he had to go to the emergency room. See, and it was in the news back then.
I'm a different type of breed, first of all. You're not even going to get that close to me.
Right. And that's where I was, because they sent me in that class. And that very student, for some reason, wasn't arrested, but we got his attention clearly and quickly. And I'm not even going to think about nothing like that and get myself in trouble. So, you know,
that must also be kind of different too, because that's high school, you know. And the kids are probably a lot bigger than they are in middle school.
So true.
When I'm in a room, of course, there are some that are taller than me. But when it comes to like physical size, I'm much bigger than the students there. But not even with just me, though. I know they respect me, you know. So it's not even because of my stature. It's
because
of my personality.
The way you carry yourself.
Like that, I am that. They respect me.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't even try anything like that. But even with the other teachers, though, they don't do anything like that of that nature. They might throw something, but they're not necessarily throwing it at the teacher. There's been some incidents where a marker or an eraser has hit a teacher, but it was like they were meaning to throw it at the teacher. Definitely no physical abuse at our school. Thank God.
That's why we want to pray for our teachers, because there are schools that kids are doing that. But I think too, those schools are in areas where, you know, it tends to be that the parents are disrespectful like that. And so again, it goes back to what you're sharing, Brother Jeremiah, about that correlation between church, home, and school, or the lack thereof, you know. And so, if you could be teaching in a rough area, Lady Jen and I, you know, we had high schools there where they were pulling guns on teachers. So, you know, I mean, it's, we grew up in a battle zone. We grew up like modern day Spartans and Trojans. Okay. So, you know, and then at one point, one of my sons was in jeopardy of going to the school that his mom went to in Detroit. And I said, no. And I brought him out to New York and sent him to Colony High over there. And he did extremely well. But, sometimes I think, to the teachers might have to make a decision. And Dr. Rhonda, you're in a tough area out there in Tennessee. Tennessee has changed a lot over the last 20 years. I spent a lot of time in pretty much most of these states in the country, with the exception of the deep West Coast. And Tennessee has changed a lot. Virginia's changed a lot in 20 years. Little Rock, Arkansas is dangerous now. 20 years ago nobody was out there, you know. So, and then our country's exploded. We had 300 million as of about 20 years ago. Now we're up to 360 million, and they're projecting another 100 million by 2050. So these areas have changed, and I think what's going to have to happen is that we're going to have deep prayer and intercession. But many teachers at this point right now, until the Lord restores, are probably going to have to make a decision that you might need to leave that school system and go somewhere else. Or you're going to have the supernatural power of God intervene in that environment. And I know at Albany High, the Lord did exactly that. And then things started to, he did it. The security staff changed, the teaching assistant staff came. There was no teaching assistant staff up until that point, and the principal changed. And once all of those coalesced together, and then we started having believing Christians, the young high schoolers, coming together, as I alluded to earlier, in a massive group. And we started to see the power of God come in that school. Even the football team started winning. Now, go figure that one, because you know Albany High up at that point ain't going nothing. Okay? Even the football team started winning. So we knew the power of the Lord was touching everything then, you know? And so, you know, so we're going to need the power of the Lord in many of these school systems. But I'll tell you this, we can't be afraid. See, the Lord can bring his power into an environment and you can see it, but you have to partner with it. What happens is the Lord sends his power. He'll send angels to work with you, and you'll start to see the atmosphere and the environment begin to change. And you need to be watching, not just praying, watching to see the Lord moving pieces in and out. The last job I was working on, Brother Jeremiah, there's a guy there heading up the show, and the morale went way down. So I began to pray, and in a year's time, the Lord began to shift pieces, and I saw it, and I began to partner with it. And then I asked the Lord, he gave me a prophetic word to go to this one leader. The leader ended up replacing that leader. But before the leader got replaced, I went to this leader, and the Lord gave me a word for him. I spoke it to him. And then all of a sudden, what happened is the morale didn't come up, but the morale sinking stopped dead in its tracks. Okay. And then there was kind of a silent hush. So then the morale started coming up a little bit. And it started coming up and coming up. And then he got transferred out. This gentleman, out of all the ones there, the Lord spoke to him and said, he's given it to him. He got in place. And the morale shot through the roof. We became the number one office in the country.
Wow.
Exactly. So the Lord, when you pray and you believe in the power of the Lord, he'll start to shift the atmosphere, but it's going to require you to partner with the Holy Ghost and the holy angels. If you sit there silent, that atmosphere will change, and it will only go to a certain degree, and then it can even dissipate. If Satan puts another evil entity in place, it can dissipate, and it can be worse than it was before. So when we pray that the power of the Lord come in our churches, we pray that the power of the Lord come on our jobs, in our homes, you have to partner, believer, with the holy angels and the power of God moving. You have to commune with the Holy Ghost and say, is there anything you want me to say and do in this situation? You cannot be silent. You have got to partner, and it's going to require you to open your mouth and to do things and assist the Holy Ghost and partner with him in that work. So many times we're praying, and number one, we're not watching, so we didn't even notice the power of God was shifting the atmosphere. And then those of us who are more disciplined, we see the power of the Lord shifting the atmosphere, but we're too afraid to speak. You have to speak and trust the Lord that he's going to keep. Could I have got fired? Absolutely. But I trusted the Lord. Not only did I get fired, I prophesied in 2012 that I would leave there by resignation because the Lord would bring me into something greater. 2020, the Lord did exactly that. I resigned, and the Lord had brought me into something greater. So when you partner with the Lord, he shows you many things, but you can't be afraid to speak. And that's where the church is getting beat, and the sons of darkness are wiser in their generation sometimes. And the sons, preachers, please stop preaching that the sons of the devil are wiser than us. That's not what the scripture says. It says in our generation. Okay, and in the original Greek, it's sometimes. It's not every generation. It's not all the time. Please get the scriptures right. This is why I hate that we don't stay on the King James, because these little translations gives you a sissified version, and you get up there preaching, and you release the wrong spirit in the church, okay, psychologically. Okay, it does not say that the sons of the devil are wiser than the sons of light. It says sometimes in their generation they are, okay? They figure things out, and we haven't figured it out yet. Let's figure it out. They partner with the devil when he shows up. We did it too. All of us didn't start saved. You know, I didn't start, you know, I started in church, but the Lord encountered me at 18 years old. Okay. So I had it in me, but I wasn't actively living it till 18. Come on in the fire, power of the Holy Ghost. But we have to partner with it. Okay. Saints, we have to partner. So pray, watch, and then partner with the atmosphere as the Holy Ghost changes, as the angels of the Lord are moving people in and out. You do know angels are sent as ministers of flaming fire to assist the saints in the work that we're doing here in the earth. Sometimes ask the Lord to dispatch holy ones. They will come and they will help change things. And then you'll see the atmosphere changing, but you have to partner with it, which means you have to open up your mouth. Many people don't understand, Brother Jeremiah, when the scripture, when the apostles were praying to be full of the Holy Ghost, you know what? You know, how do you know when you're full of the Holy Ghost? You can know when you have him because you can speak in tongues. There's many ways to know. But how do you know having him and being full of him is two different things? You're full of him, it will come out of your mouth. See, when the apostles prayed, they said, Lord, grant unto your servants with all boldness we may do what? Speak the word. When the Holy Ghost fills you up, it comes out of your mouth. That's what the Lord Jesus meant in the imagery when he said, my spirit in you will be like wells of water doing what? Springing up to everlasting life, coming out of your spirit, right? Well, how does something come out of your spirit? By your words. Your word, Jesus said, my words are spirit and they are what? Life. So we tell you, speak life. You're full of the Holy Ghost when you commune with the Holy Ghost to the point a word begins to come out of your mouth. See, I'm full of the Holy Ghost right now because this word is proceeding out of my mouth. Okay? Folks talking about, I got the Holy Ghost? I know, and I'm not going to argue that. My question is, does he have you? Are you full of him to where you will speak boldly on his behalf? And if you're not full of the Holy Ghost, you won't say nothing. I'm not going to argue you have him. He's in you. We can see that by just spiritual perception. We have eyes to see in the spirit. We see in you. But what I don't see is that you're full of his presence and power. Because when you get full of his presence and power, it will come out of your mouth. It will soar right out of your spirit. And that's what we need. We need believers that are going to stand up. And if you're in the political realm, speak by the Holy Ghost in the political realm. If you're in the teaching realm, speak. If you're in the preaching realm, speak. If you're in the church or outside the church, wherever you go and the Lord sends you, open your mouth and speak, believer, because what the world has, the world needs, you have it. When the Lord says one can put 1,000 to flight, 2 10,000, you ain't going to put nobody to flight if you don't open your mouth.
Right.
Because what is the sword of the spirit but the word of God? If the word of God doesn't proceed, you're not going to have anything. All right? So, Brother Jeremiah, thank you again, sir, for receiving our invitation. Thoroughly enjoyed the conversation, thoroughly enjoyed the discussion. I'm so blessed. I got so much out of this, so full of the Holy Ghost and his wisdom through you, young man. You have wisdom beyond your years, and I thank the Lord for that. And it's because you come from great stock, but it's because you bought into that stock as well. You heeded and the word of the stock and the spirit of the stock, and you gained it, and you took hold of it, and you took it personally for yourself. And so we thank the Lord for you, for your wife. We thank the Lord, and please send her our love and our blessing for loaning you to us for a couple of hours, and your daughter as well, because as she gets older, she's loaning you too. So we thank the Lord for your family, your father, your mother, the lineage. Let Pastor Paul and First Lady Marva know that we love them. We bless the Lord for all of you, the entire Parsons family, and everybody connected to you, all the saints in the church there. We bless the Lord for you. Saints, one last time, you got all your four ways of giving. I Give You Peace Ministry, every dime goes there. You got your PayPal there, $ Walk of Peace for Cash App, 30 3rd Street, Troy, New York, 12180 you have there. And for your pledges, 518-522-5171. I was about to mess up that phone number if the media team didn't get that in there fast enough. I have photographic memory, so the 3 stuck in my mind. But that number, the word pledges stuck in there. But that five, I was going to start with that 518, but I was hoping they caught me by the time I get there. Thank you for catching me. 518-522-5171. Brother Jeremiah, we thank the Lord for you again. I hope all of you were blessed by Brother Jeremiah. We will have him on again by the Spirit of the Lord. And Brother Jeremiah, thank you again for receiving our invitation. We know that you're very busy with your with the ministry there, with your mother and father, and just yourself, just traveling all over. You know, Brother Jeremiah will be assisting on he'll be leading the praise and worship at New Birth one second, the next second he's in some basketball arena blowing the house down to the floor, you know. So like, we never know where we're going to see Brother Jeremiah. The next minute he's driving in the car singing to us. And Brother Jeremiah, can I impose one thing? Bread of heaven sent down from glory. Can we get a little bit of that Fred Hammond, because you and I are Fred Hammond head? So can get, or if you have something else from Fred that you want to give us, can we get about 20 seconds?
I got you. Bread of heaven sent down from glory. Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. You are the living word, awesome ruler, gentle redeemer. Oh, God with us, the living truth. And what a friend we have in you. You are the living word, yeah. Jesus, Jesus, that's what we call you. Manger born but on a tree, you died to save humanity. You are the living one, yeah. Jesus, Jesus, that's what we call you. Manger born but on a tree, you died to save humanity. You are the living one, yeah, yeah. So thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Brother Jeremiah, thank you for gracing us with one of the greatest voices of our time or any time. Sister Asia put the mind-blown emoji up. And that's exactly what the Lord has done in you. And you come from such great singers. And I just thank the Lord. You have your mother's power and your father's melody. He used to sit in my chair. I'd cut it and he would send that melody like that. Most people don't know, yeah, he can riff like that, right?
Yeah.
And so thank the Lord that it is amalgamated in you and just presented in such a way that the Lord's grace is clearly demonstrated. Let's go before the throne of grace. I know all of you were blessed. We're blessed. And we just thank the Lord for each and every one of you. Let's go before the throne of grace. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We are deeply humbled by your presence and your power amongst us. We thank you for leading and guiding us in this exchange, in this worship gathering. Father, you're the only one that we know that can do magnanimous things like this. And this is why we glorify you on every hand. Lord, in this Sabbath day, you commanded us in Isaiah, the 58th chapter, that we not speak our own words or do what we want to do and do our own will. And so, Father, on the remainder of this evening, let our homes be in peace. Let there be a silence that only the Holy Ghost can give and a peace that passes all understanding. And let everyone be well that's attached to us. Let us not receive any negative phone calls or anything that anyone is in any other way but peaceful and blessed. And so, Father, we thank you that you've revealed your heart and your mind to us concerning the youth of America, concerning the youth inside of our churches. You have shown us the problem, but you are the solution, and that we're clear on, that Jesus is the answer, the old saints used to sing, for the world today. And you are still the answer, King Jesus. Help us to be the light and the salt wherever we go, and help us to not only do it individually, but help us to stand together in this hour of darkness. For you said, darkness has come upon the face of the earth and gross darkness the people, but the Gentiles, the spiritual Gentiles, will begin to come to the light, to the light that is in us, because you are in us and you are the light of the world. Father, we thank you for such rich treasures that you have placed in us as your earthen vessels. And it is not by works, it is by your grace that any man should boast. We don't make our boast in any of us tonight. We make our boasts and our praises in you tonight, that he that glorieth, it brings to pass the word of the Lord, that he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. And so, Father, we have so many reasons to praise you for. Nothing to hang our heads down about. We rebuke every spirit of depression and oppression tonight. Anybody that's sad tonight, Lord, we give them the oil of joy. We give them the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Lord, we even give them beauty for ashes. Lord, begin to restore. Restore unto them the years that the locust, cankerworm, caterpillar, and the palmer worm have eaten, Father. And allow them to understand that you are with them on tonight. And your power is greater than any known power in the universe. And when you work in anyone's life, Lord, there is no one that's going to be able to stop it. And thereby your word tells us you will open doors that no man can shut, and you will close doors that no man can open. And you tell us to not lean to our own understanding, but to trust in you with all our hearts, not lean to our own understanding, but in all our ways, we are to acknowledge you, and you promise you will direct our paths. You directed our path right to this very service on tonight. And Father, you have demonstrated clearly your power and your presence in this young man, Brother Jeremiah. We pray for him that everywhere he goes, you will make you reveal yourself and make yourself known. And the power of the Holy Ghost, whether he's preaching, whether he's singing, whether he's just sharing a word of wisdom, the power of your Holy Ghost will fall right out of his majestic lips onto the person that is listening to him, and they will encounter you, Lord, and they will forever be changed. Father, we bless you on today. We give you honor and we give you glory. And Lord, we remember your word says that we love you because you first loved us. Father, we bless you on the remainder of this evening. And if anybody needs you, Lord, put us in their path or put them in ours, and we'll be faithful to discharge your oracles to them and what you have for them, that you might be a blessing to them. Father, we're here to serve you and not the other way around. In King Jesus' name, we bless you, Father. Amen and amen. Amen. All right, everybody in the Facebook forum, we're going to release you at present time. Brother Jeremiah, again, thank you for receiving our invitation and being with us. And Brother Jeremiah, if you want a copy of this, please let Lady Jen know, and we'll send you one as soon as it's produced, so you can share with whoever you'd like to share with. And it will also be up on our YouTube page, so if anybody wants to see them, we'll share it with you. You can share it. If you don't feel, just send them over there to the page and they can get it over there. All right. We love everybody in the Facebook forum. We love you all on tonight, and we can say that First Lady Brother Jeremiah and myself, because we preach the unadulterated word of the Lord to you straight with no chaser, non-watered down and non-filter. Do we give you the word of the Lord? And that's why we can divinely say we love you all on tonight. We don't just say that, we qualify it. All right. And so be blessed on the remainder of this evening. We bid you all a good night for now.